Horizon Zero Dawn is what you get when you ask a furry that's really into mecha animes to make a game, and it's amazing. In an era full of remakes and sequels, Horizon Zero Dawn is a standout game with an incredible and original IP. I mean, on paper, the idea kinda sounds flat.
Yeah, so basically it's like Big Mech Hunter 5, but the animals are made of metal.
But man, this game is so much fun! It's a vegan's wet dream. You get the rush of murdering helpless deer with none of the guilt that comes from blowing up an innocent animal. And listen, I'm no stranger to wet dreams. I wash my sheets 8 times a week, so making myself experience another is no big deal. I thought up a challenge just for this game. Can I beat Horizon Zero Dawn on the hardest difficulty, ultra hard, without using the bow? Now that might sound a little easy at first, especially if you played the game before because you already know there's a bunch of different weapons. But the bow is the main weapon of the game, and it's the weapon the devs build the gameplay and story around. It's the most versatile weapon in the game, while all the others are extremely situational. Like sure, I can use the rope caster in this challenge, it's not a bow, but all the rope caster does is pin machines to the ground for a few seconds. That's not really something I can use to damage enemies. There are a bunch of different weapons that all do different things, and I'll explain them as I get them during the run, but each one is used for a specific function, and because of that, it forces me to play the game according to that weapon's playstyle. And that's the real challenge for this run. To make it harder, all the special weapons that do high damage, like explosives, require a lot of valuable and specific resources to craft their ammo. You get those resources from killing machines that have the ability to drop them, which means if I'm not killing machines that can drop the resources I need, I will quickly run out of ammo I can craft. In a normal run, this isn't a problem because I could just switch to my bow if that happened. Standard bow ammo is made of resources found on every machine, so it's impossible to run out. But that's not the case for me. So in order to fight effectively, I'm going to have to be strategic about how and when I use my weapons. There is melee in this game, but it doesn't do that much damage on the hardest difficulty, so it's not really helpful against stronger enemies. And playing on ultra hard essentially makes this a one-hit KO run. So I gotta play smart, or else I'm gonna end up like your mother's second pair of lips, completely obliterated by a machine.
Seriously, and I'm not exaggerating, this ruins my childhood.
Start a new game and set it to ultra hard, just like me when I wake up. The game starts with a flashback of 10-year-old Aloy giving some kids some berries before he gets schooled by his mother for interacting with me. Aloy is an outcast. She is shunned from the tribe and forbidden to talk to them. You don't know why yet, but I assume it's because she's ginger. Ran away out of frustration, but my 10-year-old brain still hasn't developed proper motor function skills, so I end up falling down this cave where Aloy dies and the game ends. So yes, you can beat Horizon Zero Dawn with no bows. No, I'm just joking. She gets lucky and lands in some water. Exploring the cave, you find the ruins of the Ancients, a society of humans that existed before Aloy's. Way more advanced in technology than the current tribal society, but somehow they were all wiped out, and any connection between the current society and the Ancients was severed. Found a dead body, and like any normal child would do, Aloy touches it and then puts its Dorito-looking earpiece on. Turns out it's some sort of super advanced AR device. No, not that type of AR. This somehow still has battery left, even though it's been like 1,000 years since it was last charged. Take notes, Apple. The Dorito thingy is called the Focus. It's basically what the Ancients use as their smartphones, and because I have it equipped, I can see and interact with the tech inside the ruins. With the Focus, I'm able to open this door, and I'm able to watch this random dude's weird birthday message to his son, I guess. I mean, he says daddy sure does love his little big man, so it's possible he's in a very kinky gay relationship and he's talking to his bottom? I don't know, man. Further down the cave, I hear Roast calling me and I follow his voice to a way out. Pork Roast helps Aloy out before reminding her that these places are forbidden, and using old technology is forbidden. But Aloy does the good old trick all 10-year-olds know. Just throw a tantrum till your parents give up.
No! No!
Roasted Potatoes does exactly that and lets Aloy keep it. I know all this info about the Focus seems useless right now, but explains why Aloy has and uses it and why basically no one else does. She's already an outcast, what should she care if she breaks another rule? Oh, Goat Roast, by the way, is Aloy's guardian. He isn't biologically related to her. Pan Roasted Fish takes Aloy down to the valley to hunt. This is the tutorial section of the game, and I knew it was probably going to be the first fail of the run. After helping Roasted Tofu kill a watcher, he makes me craft arrows from its parts before lining me up to shoot a strider with my bow. With no other weapons, I need to try some strats to get him killed without using my bow. First, I tried stealthing up to the strider for a melee stealth kill, but the second I get close, I'm detected. And once I'm detected, a cutscene plays where Rabbit Roast kills the machine for me, and the section resets. So I can't get detected by the machine, or I will fail. I also don't have my spear yet, so meleeing or stealth killing is not an option anyways. Now, because I'll fail the second I'm detected, I had trouble scouting the area to see what my options are. I only had the small patch of high grass to hide in. So I cheese the game and use photo mode. In it, I'm able to see my surroundings clearly. I spot a river nearby, so I tried luring the strider into the rushing water with my rocks, hoping the environment would kill it for me, but that didn't work. It just stands in the water like an idiot. Try looking up any percent speedruns to see if there are any glitches to get past shooting the strider here, but there aren't, which makes sense. Speedrunners wouldn't bother finding a skip for something like this when shooting the strider normally is already really fast. Unless it was a glitch to skip the whole tutorial section, but I didn't find one for that either. Last thing I could think of doing is trying to sneak past the Strider into the next part of the tutorial, but once I got far enough, the game would just load me back in to right before we spotted the Strider. With no other options, I shot the machine, getting my first fail of the run. The Strider didn't like that and decided to take out its anger on roast chicken. Oh, getting a fail this early is not a good sign, but I'm no good at reading signs anyways. I failed my driver's test like 3 times. Apparently, hitting an old lady with your front bumper is an instant fail. Like, she was gonna die in the next few years anyways. What's the difference if I sped that up? Come on. You find a kid trying to parkour, but just like Andy Bernard, he ends up almost killing himself.
Parkour, parkour!
Aloy disobeys Roast Beef Chuck's order to not help him and starts sneaking her way to the boy who can't parkour. Because of the focus, Aloy can see and track machine movements. She can also spot and identify the machine's weakness and strengths, and because she's one of the few people that uses this piece of technology, it makes her seem so much better of a hunter in comparison. It's why Lamrose didn't want her to go save the boy. To him, it seems impossible, but to her, through the focus, it seems easy. After saving Teb, Aloy gets nailed in the head with a rock by some other kids. Yeah, if you know a 10-year-old that gets joy out of whipping rocks at other kids' heads, it's probably a good sign that kid is gonna turn out to be a serial killer. Before Aloy throws one back at him, I get my first flashpoint. I can choose from 3 options. The heart, the one for people with compassion for others, or as I like to call them, pussies.
Oh, I believe we should be nice to other people.
Only losers think that. Like, just losers are the only people that think that. The cauliflower? It's supposed to be the smart action, the one nerds pick. I don't know why they used the cauliflower as a symbol. They should have used that mushy thing in our heads that lets us think and stuffs. The rock symbol. This is the best move in rock, paper, scissors. Like, if you had to rank the moves, it goes 1 rock, 2 scissors, but only because that's the name of, like, a sex thing. And then 3 rock again because it's so cool. It's the badass choice that only alphas choose. So, of course, I, someone who spends all their free time playing video games and then making way too long YouTube videos about them, am an alpha and chose that option. Aloy throws a rock at the mini Jeffrey Dahmer, but before I crack him open like an egg, Pot Roast shoots down the rock with an arrow so no one gets hurt. If he missed that rock, he would have totally just ended up shooting one of the kids, which is definitely a worse outcome than a kid being hit by a rock. So yeah, slow roasted chicken isn't the brightest. He should probably get his cauliflower checked out. Aloy starts asking him questions about her birth and her mother. He tells her the only ones who know the truth about her birth are the matriarchs, the religious leaders of the tribe. But because Aloy is an outcast, she isn't able to speak to them, or anyone else in the tribe, unless she competes in the Proving. No, that's not the name of a really cool YA novel. It's a physical test young adults compete in to see if they're ready to become fighters for the tribe, known as Braves. The winner of the Proving will not only become a Brave, but will also get an audience with the Matriarchs, where Aloy can finally ask them about her birth. So Jamie Oliver's Sunday Roast Dinner Family recipe starts training her. I get this cool little montage where Aloy learns how to climb, how to not kill rabbits, I guess, and how to fall to her death. After the montage, I'm officially in the open world. Well, the tutorial section of the open world, but still. And as an adult, Aloy now has a spear so I can melee. For the time being, the only way I'll be able to kill is with stealth or melee attacks. I don't have any other usable weapons at the moment. Talked to Tomato Glaze Meat-Free Roast where he asked me to do a few errands for him. What am I, his little boy? Want to show you how to hunt animals for meat and skins, want to show you how to make fire arrows even though I won't be using them, and want to introduce you to merchants and a new weapon called the Tripcaster. The Tripcaster is not a bow, obviously, so I finally have a weapon I can use. With it, I can create a tripwire to set up traps for machines to walk into. The only problem is this version of the Tripcaster only allows me to use 1 ammo type, and all it does is stun enemies. So I can do this, roofie the enemy with my wire, run to the back of them for some shots with my long and hard stick. Giggity. I got destroyed a second later by his buddy. Even the weakest machines in the game can one-hit kill me on ultra hard. Before continuing with the story, I want to spend some time grinding so I can level myself up, gain skills, and stockpile on supplies. Especially because I know the next main mission has me fighting my first large machine, and at this point, I still don't have any weapons that do damage other than my spear. Watch some Striders kill each other while they attack me. This is like watching a hardcore mosh pit. After about an hour grinding outside missions, I did 1 more before heading to the main quest. This mission is pretty hard for my current level, but this mission is special because completing it is the only way to upgrade Aloy's spear damage in the base game. Tracked down a scrapper and got led to its den, where a few others and some watchers started attacking me. Got beat faster than Flash beats his own meat. Side note, he's gonna have some like sort of extra strength lube for that, or else he's just gonna rub his thing down to a needle point. So on my next try, I use my Tripcaster and a critical hit combo to take down the scrapper fairly quickly. Critical hit is a skill I unlocked that lets me do very high damage to stunned or downed enemies. And speaking of skills, let me quickly break down what skills I'm going to unlock as the game progresses so I don't have to keep mentioning it as I play through the challenge. With no weapons at the beginning of the game, I have to unlock all the skills that will let me do high damage with my spear. This includes critical hit skills, the first 2 stealth strike skills, and the 2 strike damage boost skills. I'm not getting any skills in this tree related to melee. Although it seems like it'd be a good idea for my playthrough, none of these skills are actually that useful. I mean, only one of them actually increases my spear damage, and it's the last skill in the branch, so it would cost me 9 skill points just to get it. After getting all the strike skills, I'll slowly be unlocking the rest of the tree, mainly focusing on the rest of the stealth skills, skills related to resources, and skills related to health. Before heading to the main quest, I unlocked my next critical hit skill to increase damage even more. Without it, I don't think this this next fight is possible. Roast Beef and I head towards a village where I have to fight my first large machine, a Sawtooth. Unlike the machines I've fought so far, the Sawtooth is designed for combat. It's very aggressive and has a lot of health. So my best plan of attack is to stun the Sawtooth with my Tripcaster and then run in for critical hit. Think of it like pepper spraying someone so they're stunned before decking them with the baseball bat. The Sawtooth, being a larger machine, takes two wires to stun him, not one. So to make the fight harder, I have to make sure he's hitting both wires at once or else I'll become flatter than your mother's ass. That's a joke. We both know your mother's ass is huge. The big problem with using the tripwire is the way the weapon works. A machine has to walk into the wire. But because of the machine's attack patterns, a lot of them being pretty crazy, often the machine would move in a way that made it difficult to predict its movements, or it would just jump over the wire while lunging it. Got marked on my first try, but on my second, I made sure to set up a few more tripwires before my attack, and after 5 critical strikes, I killed the Sawtooth. I know this looks kinda easy, like I did kill him on my second try, but machines the size of the Sawtooth are very common. A majority of the fights won't just be me versus one machine, there'll be a bunch of other machines or humans attacking me at the same time. This was only easy because it's an isolated fight designed to be an introduction to the game's combat. With the Sawtooth dead, it's time to head into town for the proving.
Hi guys, hope you're well, we're gonna make roast beef.
At the village entrance, air-fried pork's rock belly talks to me one more time before I head in. Aloy becomes a brave, she'll no longer be an outcast, but he will still be one, meaning this is probably the last time they will talk. Beginning an emotional cutscene, you get another flashpoint. And something I didn't mention earlier is how pointless these are. It doesn't matter what you choose, there's no changes to the story. At most, sometimes your decisions here will be referenced by you or the characters involved at a later point, but that's it. It's a purely cosmetic game mechanic. It doesn't like ruin the game or anything, it can't because it won't change the game, but it does kind of seem stupid to have the ability to dramatically influence a preset character's personality, but for only one sentence and for it to have no actual consequences. But like I said, it's just cosmetic, it only affects the player's experience. After I tell Negroni roast chicken good riddance like I'm the cool Peter Parker,
gonna cry?
I head into town. Once in town, I meet Teb, the kid I saved after he ate a few years ago. As a thanks, he gives me my first outfit. A bit later on, I meet Olin, the first person Aloy has ever met that also has a focus. Before Aloy can question him about it, Aaron, a man who shaved the middle part of his beard and then pasted it onto his forehead, interrupts me. Found Olin again, he tells me he digs up runes for a living, which is where he found his focus. But then he begins to be a bit like weird and starts saying ominous things like, go enjoy yourself, make every day count. Kind of like he thinks something terrible is about to happen. Very sus indeed. In the sleeping cabin, I meet the other kids from town who are also competing in the proving. That includes the asshole who threw the rock at me when I was 10. His name is Blast. Of course it is. Like every teenager bully in media always has a stupid name like that. It's either Blast or Clifton or like my high school bully. Father. Doesn't really matter what they say to each other here anyways, because spoiler, they don't live too much longer. The proving is just some parkour, it's not hard at all. There is a part at the very beginning where I have to kill a grazer. Thankfully grazers don't have a lot of health, so I can down it in just a few melee attacks. Aloy finishes first, and then the judge does this like bait and switch.
An outcast? Win the proving? Never. For she is a brave now.
Yeah, kind of a dick move to give the winner of the contest a mini heart attack, but don't worry, she gets what's coming for her. End of the contest turns into a recreation of the world's first school shooting. ARs didn't exist back then, so in year one they just used a bow and arrow to shoot up rock carving class. After the cutscene I gotta fight the attackers, and with no ranged weapons yet, my only option is to melee them. This was hard because there are so many enemies, so if I stop rolling to fight one, the others will shoot me. I have to make sure that I'm always rolling, and I only stop to attack, otherwise I'm risking getting hit. Cleared the first wave, then I have to fight another two. Like Days Gone, a big benefit from fighting human enemies are the health items they drop, especially in this game where I found myself low on heals often. As the fourth wave starts, I get a cutscene introducing me to human leaders. Leaders are strong human enemies that carry a very powerful weapon. In this case, it's a dude's machine gun. He shreds Vala and then Blast, like the moron he is, runs out of cover towards her for no reason and gets multiple glory holes installed into his frame. The leader was very annoying because he could fire a constant stream of bullets that just obliterated my health, but on the second try, I realized I could lure him behind this rock and just impale him with my hard stick. Leaders will drop their weapons when they die, and Aloy can pick them up and use them until they're out of ammo, which is what I did. Went to go beat up the last guy, but I accidentally hit X instead of O, so instead of rolling out of the way, I jumped into his flame arrow. Nice. Next try, I got killed so hard I defied the laws of physics. Nice. Then the life after that, I used the gun to finish off all the enemies. Nice. Inspected one of their bodies and found out they're using focuses as well. As she's doing that, Aloy gets snuck up on by the leader of the leaders. Well, I'm just assuming he's the leader of the leaders. He doesn't introduce himself, kind of just starts choking Aloy, so all we know for sure is that he's kinky. Also, how the f*** did a man that large sneak up on Aloy? Isn't she supposed to be an expert hunter or something? Shouldn't she have heard him? Right before he tosses me off a cliff to my death, Roast Dinner comes back to save the day. Well, he tries to at least, A for effort. In a final attempt to save my life before the attackers blow up the mountaintop, Roast Beef Wellington tosses me off a cliff. That's right, he tosses me off the same cliff he just saved me from being thrown off. He even has the audacity to say survive before he does it.
I don't know why this man thinks throwing me off a cliff will save me. It might be because all the blood loss reduced his mental facilities to that of an infant, but we'll never get to know because he does not make it off that mountaintop.
Guess that survived and then threw her off a cliff? What are you doing?
In my headcanon, this is him trying to kill me because I told him off earlier. Got carried into town by the Matriarchs, where I wake up a while later. Found the focus I got from one of the goons and examined it to find a video message from their kinky leader. They are ordered to kill me and kill any witnesses that saw it happen. They found out who I was through Olin's focus, which is why he was acting very sus the day before. He must have known this was gonna happen. The only reason they want to kill me is because I look like some mysterious woman. I thought it was because Aloy is ginger. I mean, that's why I want to kill her. But I guess I was wrong. Teresa, one of the matriarchs, takes me to the place I was born. Assuming Aloy is gonna meet her mother, she asks her about her when Teresa says Aloy was born from the mountain. Like she was pushed out of a rocko sea or something. One day the matriarchs were hanging out in a room nearby when they started to hear the cries of a baby and came to this room to find Aloy on a platform. Not understanding technology and being all superstitious, they believe the mountain is some sort of god that created her somehow. Aloy gets up on the platform and the door turns on, where it scans my identity. It recognizes me as the same lady the enemy's focuses recognize me as, but something called the Alpha Registry is corrupted so the door won't open. Now it's not told to the player yet, but at this point it's super obvious, especially because of the little graphic that says Aloy is 99.47 DNA matched to the mysterious woman. Aloy thinks that woman is her mom, but she's actually that woman's clone. And for whatever reason, the runes of the ancients recognize that person as someone important enough to turn back on after hundreds of years of me dormant. And for a group of killers to travel all the way to Nord territory just to kill her. So who the hell is she? And who slash why was Aloy cloned 20 years ago? What happened? The only leads to go on now are fixing the Alpha Registry so the door will open, and Olin, he obviously has something to do with the killers. So Teresa's and the other matriarchs give Aloy the status as a Seeker. No, not the role from the made-up sport written by the Queen of Turfs. In this game, Seeker basically gives Aloy the ability to freely travel throughout the world, meaning from this point on, I can go anywhere in the game, not just Nora grounds. So soon I can start grinding and do more side missions to level myself up before continuing with the main story. Before leaving the village though, I have to fight my first Corruptor. Corruptors are very dangerous machines that have the ability to enslave other machines and make them fight for them. To make it worse, Corrupted machines, depicted with red wiring, are stronger than normal machines of the same type. Thankfully, before the fight starts, there's a few seconds I can use to set up traps for the door. This helped a lot because I took out a few of the Corrupted Striders while they were stunned. Unfortunately, I don't have a lot of resources right now, so I can't make any more tripwires. And without enough to stun the Corruptor, my only way to damage it is, once again, just melee attack. Fighting it was hard because I didn't have a lot of heals. So once I used up a little I have, I'm like a stepmom in a porno, completely f***ed. This was a constant problem in the run. Even at higher levels, I seemed to always get low or run out of heals when I had tough fights. You do regen some health, but it's only about a quarter of your total, and eventually, just like the skull of my late infant son, I was crushed. The second try was going about the same as the first, but I decided to stay back from the Corruptor so the rest of the villagers could get it weak for me. After a minute of running away from the scary machine like the brave warrior I am, the Nora villagers had got it weak enough for me that I thought it was okay for me to start attacking it. Almost died, but I landed one last heavy attack as the Corruptor started to reposition and killed it. Aloy defiles yet another corpse, she does that a lot, and discovers the piece of machinery that lets the Corruptor enslave machines, and just attaches it to her spear, which is totally how technology works in real life. You want to extend your phone's battery life? Just tape a Duracell to the back of it. Teb says goodbye and drops the worst pickup line I've ever heard.
I think you're a blessing from All Mother.
Yeah, don't tell other people they are blessings for God. That goes straight to their head. Last time I did that, the chick started a cult saying she was the second coming of Christ. I call Cap though, she only slept with me once, so there was only one coming of Christ. Ofer. My name is Christopher. Like, Christ. Oh, okay, sorry. With the Corruptor guts taped to the bottom of my spear, Aloy wants to go out to see if she can actually use it on machines, so I head out to test it on some Striders. Yeah, it didn't go great on my first try, so I attempted stealth on my second, but somehow got detected and then the machines started killing each other again. Even after they killed me, they were still attacking each other. Finally got close to one in stealth and overrode the machine. Overriding is a process that allows Aloy to turn machine friendly for a while, or indefinitely once I get the skill for it. Some you can use as mounts, and others will fight for you. I can only override machines that are unaware of me or incapacitated, and in order to override specific machines, I have to unlock them first by completing their corresponding cauldrons, a type of side mission that I won't be doing for a while because cauldrons are typically pretty hard and I'm very weak right now. At the Nora gates, I meet Varl, which is less of a name and more of an onomatopoeia for vomit. He asked me to go find the Nora war party that was tracking down the killers, fearing that they might have been killed as well. After that conversation, I'm finally out of the tutorial slash beginning area of the game, so I can now start grinding.
What are your thoughts on Grindr?
First thing I did was craft some traps. There are three different types, but only one does damage, and it's quite a bit, so for the time being, it's my strongest weapon. Headed to the nearest hunting grounds and started grinding for loot. Hunting grounds are locations where Aloy can compete in minigames for rewards, but even if I don't do the minigames, I can still go into the grounds and hunt there. And because these areas are meant for hunting, they always respawn large herds of machines in an environment that is made for killing them. In this one, the machines are all grazers, which are weak and come with four canisters of
Blaze. Blaze is this game's version of gas, which I just realized might be an inside joke about weed. So you use a lot of it in explosive and fire weapons, and right now, explosive traps are the only way I'm able to do high damage. If I want to explain all that in a less confusing way, this place good, this place very good. I'll be coming back here a lot to loot and grind during the run, because spoiler alert, explosives are basically the only way I'll be able to do high damage the entire run. Use some traps to blow up a deer like I'm Lenny Hickerson, or like he'd say. I use the traps to pre-cook and pre-gut the meat. After a bit of grinding, I headed out to complete my first tall neck. Tall necks, or Candaces, are giraffe-like machines that survey the area and then send the data to the other machines so they know the local terrain. So if Aloy climbs up one and overrides it, she gets all the same data, revealing a large portion of the map. Oh, and I get a skill point, so completing these are super useful. Was doing some side missions for XP when I got one that needed me to kill two
Sawtooth,
which right now for me is like finding an empty Starbucks in a white neighborhood. Impossible. Now I tried everything I could do here. I tried setting up ambushes, I tried stealth attacks, I tried blunt force, but each one ended with my death. I only had shock tripwires to stun and a few traps to do damage. Other than that, my only method of attack was melees, which is basically impossible when I have to dodge two large and fast enemies that kill me in one hit. Closest I got was during one try where I was able to kill one of the two because he got stuck in the riverbank and I could do the death from above stealth attacks till he died. But even after that, I still got one hit by the second Sawtooth. Only useful thing that came out of all of this was when I learned machines have a predetermined range and will retreat back if they overstep it. I started setting up traps between these two buildings, but every time a Sawtooth lunged at me over here, they would retreat back instead of continuing to chase me, implying that this is out of their range. This is good info to know because it means I can use ranged weapons from outside the machine's predetermined range and not have to worry too much about taking damage from the machines. But because I'm playing with no bow, I currently do not own any ranged weapons, so that's not going to help me out for this fight. After over an hour and 15 minutes just trying to kill two enemies for a side mission, I gave up. F*** that. I just need to grind out loot, XP, and money for new weapons. I don't actually need to beat this mission. And at this point, this is a bigger waste of time than my parents' marriage. So I had to go do a bandit camp nearby. There are a few of these in the open world you can do. They give you a good amount of XP and aren't too hard. Still only had my melee weapon to fight them, so I did die a lot, but after 10 minutes, I was able to kill them all. Fun fact about dead people, both in real life and in this game, you could take money from their corpses as long as no one sees you do it. So after this, I had enough guapo to buy a blastling and a rattler. Blastlings are the answer to the good old question of, what would have happened to Goliath if David lobbed an M80 at his head instead of a rock? And the Rattler is basically a submachine gun. The sling does high damage, so I will be using it a lot, but the Rattler is meant for close combat with weak enemies, so I'll mainly be using it on humans right now. In order to craft explosive ammo for the sling, or explosive traps, I need metal vessels, and I don't have a lot of them. A machine that drops metal vessels and is fairly weak is the Scrapper, so I started farming them. I'm still stupid weak, and mentally. So the best plan of attack is to start stealth killing them, but after downing two of them, I didn't get any metal vessels. The third one I killed, one that was attacking me, did drop some. Did this a few more times to confirm, but yeah, for some reason, if I stealth killed the Scrapper, they would not drop any metal vessels, the one resource I need from them. So farming them is going to be a lot harder than it needed to be because I can't kill them in stealth. Died a bunch while farming them, but an hour later, I was able to kill enough of them to stock up on a decent supply of metal vessels. Got the ammo crafter skill so I can make more out of what little I have, and I bought a rope caster. Now fully loaded like your racist uncle's F-150, I headed back to the Sawtooths to get my revenge. But for real though, now with a f*** ton of traps to place down, I was able to kill both of them. Basically, I'd set up an ambush with some traps and shock wires, and if I stunned them, I would plant more traps next to them before getting a critical hit and waking them back up. That way, when they got up, they would immediately run into my newly placed traps. I didn't even get good loot or a good reward for killing them and finishing the mission. I just really wanted the satisfaction of killing the two assholes that made me waste over an hour of my life. Did one more side mission where I had to fight off a long neck, use my rope caster to tether in place, making it way easier. Was talking to a guy when he got triple YY no scope by a stalker. Stalkers are one of my favorite machines in the game. They're basically what happens when you cross the Predator with a member of FaZe Clan and a Panther. Very annoying to fight because they will go invisible and snipe you from afar, and one of these shots takes out about half of my health or more. Thankfully, every machine has some sort of elemental weakness, and the Stalkers are weak against shock, so I just set up a few tripwires and landed critical hit every time I got stunned, till I killed him. Tried clearing out another bandit camp, but it was like the time I tried to get my wiener to fit in the electric pencil sharpener. No matter how hard I forced it, I was the one that just kept getting hurt. So I called it off and took out my rage on those who deserved it. This cute little bunny! Started a new stream off right by portraying the extremely offensive Italian stereotype, Luigi. I'm just joking. This is my Halloween stream, and I'm reusing the outfit I wore for my band's Halloween show because I'm too poor to buy another. Actually, speaking of my band, Waste Youth, I'm gonna do a shameless quick plug here. We dropped a new song called She Don't. If you like heavy music, please check it out. Links in the description. Anyways, with a bunch of loot, new weapons, and more skills than before, I was ready to continue with the main quest of the game. Started off by tracking down the Nora War Party. I almost got bodied by another Sawtooth, but Snania helps me out. They found an enemy camp, and now they want me to clear it out. I don't know why they can't do it, but whatever. After being sent to meet God on my first attempt, I decided I wanted to test out how much work my teammates can do for me. At this point, I didn't know if my teammates could kill many enemies for me, or any at all. So after starting the fight, I ran away, killed the stragglers following me, and hid in cover as my teammates did the fighting. At first, I thought they were as useless as me and couldn't kill anybody, but after hiding for like a solid 5 minutes, they were able to clear the entire area. Now, obviously, I didn't need to do this. I probably could have fought my way through this section, but I'm glad I tested this out, because now I know for future fights, if I'm low on ammo, health, or I'm just too weak to fight, or lazy, I could probably just hide and let my teammates do it for me. Unfortunately, for majority of the fights, Aloy is by herself, so I won't always have the opportunity to be a lazy ass and let my team carry me through this challenge. Explain to the chat why me and Dan chose to dress up as Mario and Luigi for a show.
In 1993, they made a Super Mario's live action movie. It was the most insane thing ever. They made it basically, instead of like it being like about a video game and stuff like that, it was like there was a secret portal to like another world in like a different dimension, and Mario and Luigi are just normal plumbers and they get sucked in and they go there. I love it. It's so crazy. It's like, it's definitely one of those that it's so bad it's good movies, 100%. And the fact that they just ran so wild is insane.
I'm not kidding when I say this is the goofiest movie ever made. This is what the Goombas look like. And they made Yoshi a velociraptor that eats someone mid-film. I could talk for hours about how crazy this movie is, but maybe I'll save it in case I ever do a challenge run on any of the Super Mario games. Just do yourself a favor and go watch the trailer for this thing, cause it's f***ing stupid.
Super Mario Brothers, this ain't no game.
Cleared some corrupted zones with my amazing melee skills. While fighting through one of them, I did learn something very important. If I use a potion while running or walking away, Aloy will stop to ingest it, which means I'll lose all momentum, and if I'm running from something while desperately healing before I die, I'll just stop mid-sprint and get murked. That sucks, because it makes healing a lot harder to do, and it makes escaping near-death situations while healing impossible. Now, this confused me a bit, because I know I've been healing while moving before and not stopped, so how did I do it then, and why is it different when I'm just running? After a bit of experimenting to figure it out, I realized Aloy can heal without stopping if I heal while in the middle of an agility animation. Which means if I'm jumping, sliding, or rolling, and I press the heal button mid-animation, I won't stop or lose momentum. I'm pretty sure this happens because the game decides to trump the agility animation over the healing animation. They aren't gonna make Aloy come to a screeching halt mid-roll so she can stand up and throw some berries in her mouth. Very happy I figured this out because it helped me a lot in the run, and if you ever play this game, which you definitely should, now you know how to heal while moving. You're welcome. You should maybe subscribe to me as a thank you. I don't know. On the way out of the Nora territory, I noticed an abnormally large amount of heals on the ground, which means one thing. There's gonna be a tough fight up ahead. At the gates was another corruptor, and a few small machines, but thankfully I spent all that time hoarding metal vessels and blaze, so I knew I could make a bunch of traps and bombs. As the machines were chasing me throughout the hillside, I would stop to place traps and bait the machines into walking into it. The traps do so much damage that they one-hit most small machines. After clearing those guys out, all that was left was the corruptor. With the sling, I can now deal high range damage, and after 5 or 6 shots, the corruptor was low and I decided to engage in some BDSM for the final blow. Wink, wink. But while tying him up, he was killed by my ally shooting from the gate. I know this because I didn't get any XP from the kill. It was annoying because I wasted all those bombs for nothing, but it was great to know that my allies can kill large machines with me. Before continuing with the main quest, I want to go to the first cauldron to unlock more machine overrides. Cauldrons are where machines are made and are pretty tough, but the first one is relatively easy, and with a ton of explosives on me, I'm confident I could do this with minimal deaths.
Oh shit.
Now the great thing about cauldrons is that I can skip majority of the fight here. Usually the only part that's necessary is the section at the end where you have a boss fight with a large machine. Before I could do that though, Scloppy? Scaloopy? Scloppy? I don't know how to pronounce the name. They asked if I could buy fake ass hair, which then prompted my deranged brain to figure out if you could actually buy fake ass hair or real ass hair on eBay or something. Almost googled pubic hair live on Twitch while showing my screen, but remembered to switch it last second. Found some fake stuff you could buy on Amazon for like $80, which is a total rip. I could shave off some of my cat's hair and glue it around my shaft for free if I really needed it. Now I'd switch the stream scene back to my browser so I could show the chat the fake stuff I saw because there was nothing TOS there. But I forgot to switch it back before clicking another link. Don't worry, I didn't show anything TOS by accident. And if I did, I wouldn't admit it in this video because then Twitch might use it as evidence to ban me, okay? So, good thing I did switch because if I had scrolled down on that website, I would have 100% been banned again. Found some interesting stuff while snooping around, like pub oil, which is beard oil but for your curlies downstairs. Also found these shirts. Don't know what occasion you would wear these. Maybe a funeral, if you like hate the guy who died and want to ruin it. After trying to beat up the Shellwalker and getting almost killed by it, I decided to skip this fight and make my way to the end room of the cauldron. Now these boss fights always have you fight a machine from that cauldron that is both very dangerous and at a way higher level than normal. But you can prep them with traps before releasing the machine from this dome thingy. So I set up a bunch of explosive traps and some shock wires before letting them out. The traps took care of the small machines that spawned with it, and using a fire resist potion here made this fight a lot easier, as majority of the fire bellowback's attacks were ranged fire attacks, obviously. Using the same strat I did in the Sawtooth, stunning it and then throwing down traps beside it before getting a critical hit, helped me control this fight. And with a ton of firepower from my sling, I was able to take it down in one life. Again, this seems easy, but it still took me a full 3 minutes of constant fire with my strongest weapons to kill one machine. I wanted to try out my new overdrive, so I found some Sawtooths, snuck up on one, overrid it, and then watched it duke it out with its brother. Honestly, pretty cool to watch. And after 15 seconds, one was dead. Remember how long it took me to kill two Sawtooths earlier? Look how quick it takes me to kill these two now. That's how useful overriding is. After listening to the War Chief's very important speech, I went with the team to clear some cans. But like the smart man I is, I just hung back and let the NPCs do the work for me. Just helps me save on ammo, honestly. Failed doing stealth, skipped this fight by running to the end and igniting the blaze, and once again, hung back as my team did the work. Yeah, but for real, I just hid and let them duke it out. Did another bandit camp, and with the Rattler, taking out humans is easy, as long as I have cover. Found another tall neck and went to go do it, giving them way under the recommended level to complete it. I don't have to kill anything, I just have to climb to the top without dying. Unlike this first try where I got sniped off and then crushed by the tall neck. After unlocking more of the map, I just booked it to the main city of the game, Meridian. Well, first I showed off my 100% definitely real mustache to prove to the chat that I'm technically a man and not a child.
Manscaped created the Ultra Smooth package. For men who like that package, Ultra Smooth.
Searching for Olin, I met up with a man who shares the same facial hair as Kid Rock's racist and aging fanbase. Before we search Olin's house though, I go off on a tangent and explain what oi music is to the chat. In like American stuff, we picture someone who's a skin and we're like, they're yeah. Nazi, right? But it's not, and they make a genre of music called oi. Yeah, so basically skinheads aren't originally a Nazi thing. The term skinhead was co-opted by those shitheads in the 70s to 90s. Before that, it was just a subculture from 60s Brit. So to this day, there's still people who identify as skinheads and are very proud of that, but aren't actually Nazis. And sometimes quite the opposite, like the group Sharp. Just look up oi bands on Spotify and you'll find a bunch of groups that look like they all voted for Trump, but at the same time didn't. Personally, I think it's whack to dress up as something that most of the general public assumes is Nazi related. But some of these guys got a weird victim complex and refused to dress differently. They even got this weird ass symbol, which is a skinhead being crucified. It's supposed to symbolize how all skinheads are persecuted, even only some of them are Nazis. But like, you could just change your clothes, dog. Like, just change your clothes. Just change your f***ing clothes. If people keep calling you Nazi and you aren't, then you know, maybe just stop dressing like one. I don't know what to tell you, man. Yeah, it sucks that Nazis ruined skinhead culture, but got news for you. Nazis kind of known for ruining shit. Most recently, Kanye West. Bro, was on my top 5 this year too, god damn it. Watched the real Crucifixion, which is Skinny Santa and the Heart-Shaped Box video. I then spent an hour watching music videos on YouTube with the chat. This includes great remixes like Justin Timberlake x Slipknot, and of course, the USSR anthem featuring the Queen, Britney Spears.
It's just stupid.
In Olin's house, we find out his family's being held hostage, so he's probably not being evil willingly, and where he's hanging out right now. There's a bunch of heals by the entrance, so you know it's gonna be a hard fight. Watch as the killers resurrected some corruptor bots right before their focuses are disabled. Someone calls Aloy and tells her that they're the one who disabled the focuses to give Aloy an edge in the fight. Whoever this is, they want to help Aloy for some reason. Tried stealth, but failed worse than I failed my grade 1-1 English exam. One corruptor I can handle, but two, not so much. I set up a bunch of traps before starting again, but even that wasn't enough firepower. The enemies are at a high level and they got much more health, so it's going to take a lot more traps to kill them. Because trap damage is static, there's no way to increase their base damage output, and I had low heals, even playing my best is not enough. I had a ton of attempts just trying to figure out how I can kill these guys. Each life I would try a different ambush, but I always set up the traps in the same area. This was done on purpose. If I left this area and went to the section below, I'd also have to fight the humans down there. But staying up here meant only a few of them would come up to fight me or take shots from far away, while I can deal with the machines separately. I kept dying. They just always overwhelmed me. I got so pissed off, I had to take a little break to cool down. That's a lie. I had to take a fat. I couldn't hold it anymore. I was waiting until the fight was finished, but at this point I was groundhogging, so I need to go drop the kids off at the pool. When I came back, I tried something different. So I know from some testing I did earlier that I could only have 12 active tripwires. If I set up any more, my longest standing wire would despawn. With this in mind, I assumed traps were the same, and I had only been setting up 12 of any given trap at a time. But if I can set up more than 12, then I could possibly make a giant pile of traps to take out one of the corruptors instantly. So I set up the traps in rows so I can count them and see the true max I could place at once. Turns out, I could do at least 24. And after getting spotted by one of the machines, I tested it out. Now, I was next to the bombs, so I ended up like a citizen in Hiroshima on August 6, 1945. But it did instantly kill one of the corruptors.
I died, but I killed it.
Took me more tries to get an attempt that worked. Sometimes I'd be spotted while setting stuff up. Other times, the humans would come investigate and get turned into ash, so I'd lose all those traps. Eventually, I got the perfect setup. The machine started attacking me, but as they were, one jumped back and landed on the giant pile of traps, killing it instantly. The second corruptor was a pain in the ass to kill. I had almost run out of meds and basically had to use all of my sling ammo and blaze to kill it, but fighting just one machine is always more manageable than fighting multiple, and eventually I killed it. Used my awesome parkour skills to get the upper hand on the rest of the human enemies.
Move, please move.
I've been seen.
What?
Olin tells Aloy everything he knows. The killers are part of a cult called the Eclipse. He doesn't know who the mysterious woman is, but he does know some rooms that have a picture of her and gives Aloy the location. He doesn't know why the Eclipse want to kill her. He tells me the large kinky guy from earlier is Helis. He's the leader of the Eclipse. He also said the Eclipse are being told what to do by a devil called Hate, something that isn't human but is directing the Eclipse. Lastly, he tells me about the machines they're resurrecting. The Corruptors aren't the only ones. There's another type called Deathbringers, which on top of being a name for multiple metal bands, is also the name that is like way too literal. It's like naming your belt the Child Behavior Corrector 7. Aloy gets to choose whether or not to save Olin, and I save him, hoping that maybe he will give me gear or something later on in the game as a thanks, but that doesn't happen, so I could have just ended him. Like all flashpoints, it doesn't make a difference. Honestly though, in my opinion, Olin's life should be spared. His family's being held hostage, he wasn't doing any of this willingly. The Eclipse recruited him just because he was an expert on ancient runes. Eren needs Aloy's help investigating his sister's murder, because apparently following these very obvious cart tracks is something only she could do through her focus. And again, it's not like a man with Eren's facial hair has the intelligence to follow two lines in the dirt. Shredded down some humans and fought some ravagers from the rooftop. Thankfully, Eren can cause machines to enter the frozen or brittle status effect. It's when the game gives them late stage osteoporosis like they're a 70-year-old woman. And like a 70-year-old woman, they are much easier to kill. Out of all the status effects, frozen is the most useful. With it, I can do up to 300% more damage for about 30 seconds. So later in the game, when I have better freeze weapons, I'll be doing that a lot. Spent 5 minutes trying to find the last clue in the investigation area. It's not even near the rest of the clues. It's up here on a ledge for some reason. Eren's too stupid to figure out what happened here, so I explained it to him. His sister and her crew were captured. The bodies were replaced with disfigured corpses and dressed in their equipment by a man named Derval to frame a different political fraction in-game. Eren is still too stupid to understand that, so he refuses to continue pursuing Derval until he double-checks his sister's body. Met the King of Mermaid. Mermaid? Oh, that's supposed to say Meridian. My bad, I've been watching a lot of Aquamarine, so I must have Mermaid on the brain and wrote that by accident. Tried to explain to the chat the politics in Horizon Zero Dawn, but forgot to unmute myself. So, fuck it, I guess you guys aren't gonna find out. After Eren realizes the dead chick is just a rando and not his sister, we meet up with Derval's hideout to find her. Derval's got a bunch of chained up machines, so naturally anyone playing the game would assume this level is set up so you can easily override the machines in stealth to kill all the humans. But for some reason, you can't override any of the machines here. I tried while they're chained up and while in stealth, but neither work. It's not like the machines are under control of the other humans. If they were, it makes sense why I couldn't override them, but that's not it, because these machines will still attack the others.
Chris, from editing here, I'm stupid as hell. So I realized the machine I'm talking about in this video that I can't override is actually a Ravager, not a Sawtooth. I thought it was a Sawtooth, but it's not. So I can't override Ravagers at this point because I don't have the skill unlocked. So I'm pretty sure you can override the machines in this mission. I'm just f***ing stupid, so... I mean, you knew that already.
The one thing I can do to make this easier is shoot off the chains of a machine and go hide in the back. If it works properly, the machine will lose sight of me and start thinning out the humans. But didn't always work properly. This level was pretty hard. The humans killed me very fast, and I still don't really have any efficient long-range weapons. Yeah, I have the sling, but its ammo is very resource-heavy, and its range isn't that far. So the best way for me to get kills was through stealth, or by popping out of cover to kill them with my rattler if they're close enough. Unfortunately, all these strats are pointless if I keep getting one shot. Aloy is weaker than my will to live. Got lucky and knocked down a Sawtooth and Log Legs at the same time, and after taking care of them, I went to go hide in the grass while Eren took care of everything for me. After 5 minutes of waiting, I got bored and headed up top to free some machines to help speed things up, but they didn't do much, and after they were done, I realized I was stuck because Aaron couldn't get any more kills. I don't think he stopped getting kills because of the way the level's coded, I think he just got himself in a position that softlocked him. It seemed like every time he'd get up from being stunned, he'd be stunned again before he could move or attack anyone. Now for some reason, the remaining enemies won't come to the second floor, so I just pulled a Kenobi and killed them from the high ground. Got into the hideout and the colors got all freaky deaky, but at the bottom we find Aaron's sister. Thank God she's still alive. Oh, wait. Never mind. With the information we got for her and clues into Rawls' hideout, we find out he's planning an attack on Meridian. So I head out to stop him when my game crashes. If you watch a few of my videos, you probably noticed that my games crash a lot. It's because my PlayStation is almost 10 years old, which sucks, but on the bright side, only 8 more years till I can fuck it. Well, legally. I do it now, it's just not legal. Maybe it's all the gunk I shot up there making the games crash. Eh, whatever.
My penis is stuck in the VCR!
Before fighting Derval, I head back to the Grazer hunting ground and grind for some more loot. Yeah, Grazers are some of the easiest machines to kill. So I took a break and showed the chat Bloodywood, my favorite Indian musical group. After, of course, this glorious man. After an hour and 20 minutes of farming, I was done. Sold a bunch of my loot so I could make enough money to buy a Shadow Tripcaster. It's the highest tier Tripcaster I can buy, and it comes with two new types of wire. One is fire, but the other one is the overpowered blast wire. It works the same way the shock wires do, but instead of stunning enemies, it explodes. It does very high damage. One blast wire at base level does 2.5 times the damage one sling bomb does. And after some quick mods, it does over 4 times the amount. This weapon quickly becomes my main method of attack. I start blowing everyone up like I'm Ted Kaczynski. Oh my god, I just realized he's related to the guy from The Office. One big negative of this weapon is the 5 blaze it takes to craft demo. That's a lot. So this will make fighting easier and faster, but it also means I'm going to have to spend a lot more time grinding out blaze in between story missions. And that's exactly what I did here. I spent the next 3 recordings and about 2.5 hours just farming machines. Mainly hunted grazers for blaze, but I also killed some scrappers for metal vessels. The only other thing I didn't note during this time was some of the hunting challenges, just did them for the extra XP, and that one part where I got stuck in a rock. Last time I was stuck in a rock, he had to use poppers to get me out, but I could just fast travel this time. For anybody that didn't get that joke, Google what happens when you do poppers. Back in the city, I went to Derval's warehouse where he was storing all the slime from the Nickelodeon's Teen Choice Awards. Side note, I think it's hilarious they invite celebrities to this event just so they can cover them in what I assume is the same amount, consistency, and color as Shrek's first load after a successful No Nut November.
You're out of my swamp.
We gotta get rid of all the slime because it's actually blaze and part of a large bomb, so Aloy comes up with a plan. Toss it out a window onto the streets below. Which, of course, is a genius way to save the city. Just bomb a different part instead. This plan seems like Aaron would think of it, not Aloy, honestly. Track Derval down to the king's palace where him and his goons start torturing the king. As they run off to find out what went wrong with the bomb, I go in and save the king. Chase Derval down and begin fighting him. U-Haul actually uses a unique weapon here, it's called the Terror Blaster. It's annoying because it throws me back a bit, and as I'm recovering from it, I would often be shot at. Using the blast wire was great though, because I was able to down Derval with one wire. But before I can finish him off, he pulls out an Amazon Echo and calls in a horde of delivery drones. The other negative of the blast wire I forgot to mention earlier is how much it sucks against flying enemies, so I can't really use my new OP weapon. Tried tying them down, getting damage in with my Rattler. It kind of worked, but I'd still get murked by the other Glithawks. The Sling Bomb is useless here because the projectiles are thrown so slow that the Hawks would be able to dodge them. After eating dirt a few times, I decided to try a strat I didn't think was gonna work, but somehow did. I used the buildings to create tripwires in air, and now all I have to do is hope some Hawks fly into them while they're getting close to attack me. And they did. I'm able to kill a hawk with just one wire, so all I gotta do is hide in this corner and keep placing tripwires in the sky. After killing them all, I went to go talk to Derval, but the game didn't really know what to do here because all the hawk bodies were on top of him. He is sent to jail, the Sun King is safe, and I'm officially done the most boring part of the main questline. Yeah, if you noticed, those last few missions really had nothing to do with the cult, the mysterious woman, or the corruptors. It's just a questline about Aaron and his sister, and it sucks, and could have been a side mission quest, but whatever, it's done, and I still got the XP from it, which is great. Before heading back to the main quest though, I want to do a few more cauldrons and tall necks just to get the boss from them so I won't have to double back later. The first cauldron had a lot of parkour. Getting to the boss wasn't hard except for this one part where I got trapped in a tight hallway by a Ravager. Oh, and that one time I slid to my death. The boss in this one is a high-level snap maw, so a robotic crocodile, or maybe it's a robotic alligator. I don't know. I decided to focus my inner Steve Irwin and become a true crocodile hunter. And no, I don't mean I'm gonna get stabbed in the heart by a stingray. Jokes aside though, I did a bit of googling about him after writing that, and I learned they named a snail after him in his honor. Meet the crikey Steve Irwinium, probably one of the best and weirdest ways to honor the world's most famous alligator lover. Do you think he topped his wife like that too? Like the last cauldron, I just set up traps before starting the fight. This time though, they were much stronger and I was able to kill the snap mob before it even got close to me. Back up top, I used what the Dark Soul community calls a perfect roll. Fought some tramplers, thought it was going well, but it wasn't. No idea what the fuck was going on here, just a crazy mess. Got greedy and tried to loot some of the bodies when a snap now saw me. Wasn't alive much longer after that. Did another tall neck, and then headed to the second last cauldron. This one is special. The cultists have gotten here first and started excavating it for parts. So instead of parkour and machines, this one is filled with stealth and humans. It's honestly not that bad. Lots of cover in the areas and lots of heals dropped by the enemies, so it's not too hard. You also don't have to kill everybody. You can just run through, which is what I did for a large part of it. The final section is a bit harder. After a small fight, they send a bunch of leaders with machine guns at you. But after killing the first one and grabbing the dropped gun, I got the upper hand. On the way back out of the cauldron, I got to fight through humans and machines that have started to pour in. These fight scenes were very fun. Being able to kill a cultist, grab his huge gun, and start hailing fire to the machines below was always a good time. Man, I sure do love murdering. I'm gonna put that on a t-shirt. After getting back to town, I sold all my loot and realized I have enough for the Shadow Rattler, but I don't have enough animal skins, so I gotta go grind those out. And I spent a long ass time trying to get some. I haven't talked about it yet, but ask anyone who's played this game and I guarantee you they will agree with me that this is the worst mechanic in the game. Hunting animals. Hunting animals is already annoying and takes a while, especially without a bow. But in order to get crafting materials, you have to get lucky because animal skins and bones have really low drop rates. And sometimes, crafting recipes will call for 5 skins. For this weapon alone, I need 2 boar skins, 2 rabbit skins, and 2 fox skins, all of which only have a 10% chance of dropping when I kill one of them. So if it takes me about 30 seconds to a minute to find and kill one animal, I gotta do that at least 10 times or more to get the loot I need. It took me 28 minutes of running around and wrecking animals on the head with my spear to get what I needed. PETA would not be proud. Then again, I also destroyed a pig last night, so they probably wouldn't like that either. Oh, the pig? That was your mother. Get owned, viewer. And please like the video. Thanks. Love you. Got the new Rattler, which has freeze bolts, so now I have an effective way to freeze machines if needed, and after modding it, it's significantly stronger than my old Rattler. So I will be using this a lot to help cut down on my blaze use.
Here's why you might want to take a tolerance break.
You're probably thinking, oh, now he's gonna start doing the main missions. Well, you're wrong, dumbass. Listen, I played this game before in Ultra Hard. Without grinding, the main questline becomes impossible. You need to have good weapons, and you need to have high enough level to continue playing through it. Like most games, the higher level you are, the more XP you need to reach the next level. And the recommended levels between these missions scale very fast. For example, the next 2 main missions recommend you be 14 and then 18. So the game expects me to level up 4 times before continuing. I'm like level 28 at this point, so I could do them, but I wanted to level up enough that I could just go through the rest of the main questline without stopping to grind out more levels, because I know the last level recommends you'd be level 34, and I'm a ways off from that right now, and I want to be way higher than that when I do it. So yeah, sorry for being annoying and making it feel like I'm delaying the actual story of the game, but I need to do this or else the challenge is just not going to be possible. I thought one of the best ways to grind out some levels was doing all the hunting ground challenges. I started out doing the stealth challenges. Those weren't too bad, took a few tries, but after I learned where the spawns were, they were pretty easy. The most annoying challenge was the one where I had to kill the stalkers, mainly because stalkers typically prefer to keep their distance from me, so using the blast wire wasn't really effective, and trying to find invisible machines while being attacked by 5 others is not exactly easy. The next hunting ground challenges I went to is a stamina trial. The first challenge, I just had to run around and pick up loot from corpses, so grave robbing. My real life experience made this pretty easy. By the way, if you're up there watching this, Grandpa, thanks for the Rolex. Got a little bit of dirt on it, but still works fine. The next challenge wasn't possible. Well, at least right now it is. The next hunting ground challenge wanted me to tie down tramplers and then remove a specific component from them. To do that, I would need to use a weapon that has high tear damage, but I don't have one. Normally, I'd be able to use tear blast arrows to do this, but without a bow, I don't have any weapons that can do high enough tear damage to remove large components. I gave up shortly after, but I want to check the game's wiki to see if there's a weapon I can use that has high tear damage. Because tear is really useful against some enemies, like the Thunderjaw. Yeah, it's a metal T-Rex. If you have high tear damage, you can remove the disc launchers from it, and then pick it up and use it against the Thunderjaw for very high damage. It's like pulling the prosthetic arm off an amputee and smacking them in the face with it. Super effective. After searching, I found the Tear Blast, the unique weapon Derval used on me. It's actually a weapon that does the most tear damage, so it's better than the Tear Blast arrows, but I can't buy it. I have to complete a certain side quest first, which sucks, because that means I have to do a lot of work just to get one weapon.
After that, I do get a free one, and it becomes available at Traders. The quest I have to do is part of the Hunter's Lodge questline, which means first I have to go join the lodge. When I get there, I'm told in order to gain membership, I have to first prove myself by killing 3 Sawtooths, 2 Ravagers, and 1 Stalker. Which has to be a joke, right? Like, they probably just don't want anybody else joining the club, so they just send hopefuls out on suicide missions? Thankfully, the Blast Wire made this easy, except for that one time when a Sawtooth detonated a wire while I was next to it, and it made Aloy die, get up, and then die again. Even a large pack of machines like this are easy to take down with the Blast Wire and some good planning. This thing is a lifesaver, man. No, not literally a lifesaver, it's still a weapon. God, my editor
writer,
so stupid. After handing the trophies, I get to start the side mission that awards me the Terra Blaster. I had to clear a town of hawks. This time, I tied one down and overrid it to help me out. It went well, but the next checkpoint wouldn't trigger because technically the last hawk was still alive, even though he's on my side now. So I betrayed him and put him down. Got to the next part and had to kill even more hawks. Yay, hawks again. But like the Durval mission, I could just place wires in the sky and bait the hawks into them. All the hawks are being drawn to the village by the hunters, leaving a bunch of scraps by the riverside. So, I can either kill these hunters, or give them a snapmaw heart to make them go away. Now, I thought I already had one on me, so I chose that option thinking it would be completed instantly. Turns out, I didn't have a spare heart. So, I did the inverse of the Wizard from Oz, and found a Tidman just to take away its heart. After giving the hunters what they wanted, I'm told to meet my sponsor at the lodge for an intervention. Oh, I mean, grab the Terra Blaster. Sorry, force of habit. But before I did that, I wanted to complete the tall neck that was right next to my location. This tall neck is surrounded by cultists. I have to kill them all to complete the tunnel, I just had to climb to the top of it. So on my first try, I attempted to climb them while being sniped, and yeah, that didn't work out so good. On my next try, I did the same thing, but spammed heals as I climbed so I wouldn't get killed, and somehow that worked. Don't ask me how Aloy was drinking potions while scaling what is basically a moving building, but it worked, so I'm not gonna complain. Back at the lodge, I got my membership and Terra Blaster. Head to the Grazer hunting grounds to complete the last challenge that I couldn't do before because I didn't have anything that did Terra damage, and here, I can show you guys exactly how it works. Doesn't have great range, but if I get close enough to the machine, I can target any component or armor and remove it. It's very useful in tough fights. Removing armor makes enemies weaker, and removing components will remove attacks related to that component. For example, if I tear off the gun on top of a Ravager, this will disable its ranged attack. The Terra game mechanic is really good, and using it in fights properly feels really rewarding and fun. In this run, not so much because of my weapons, but in normal gameplay, it's dope to strategize by shooting specific parts of the machines with your arrows. I think it's a great example of game mechanic that works really well both in gameplay and in the world building. Did a lot of grinding here. I actually spent some time grinding while not filming because at this point I knew it was just a waste of computer space, but I did actually learn something in those 2 hours of gameplay that makes this a lot easier. The hunting ground challenges can be repeated infinitely, and when starting, the machines instantly respawn. Before that, I was running away for a minute or two and then running back so the machines would respawn, but this method saved me all that extra work and time. I can't believe it took me this long to figure it out. Oh god, I'm as dumb as Aaron, ain't I? To make this even better, completing challenges would always give me a great reward. I was doing the Blast Wire challenge, which requires me to kill 6 grazers with the wire. I'm already killing them that way anyways, so I would be able to complete the trial very fast. I found this route that let me clear the machines out in about a minute. Place some wires over here and made sure the lead wire is attached to the log piles so when it blows up, it releases them. Got to the other side of the grazer herd and scared them so they run in the opposite direction, right into my wires where they would all be killed. Any grazers killed by logs that were set off by my blast wire would count as a blast wire kill. Because of this, I would kill the grazer so fast that I would get the max reward every time I complete the challenge. It gives me a box that can contain up to 14 blaze, among other valuable resources. So I got a ton of loot after doing this for a few hours. Bought the Golden Fast Travel Pack, and then the Shadow Blast Sling, which now allows me to use sticky and proximity bombs. The sticky bombs are great, because they actually do a bit more damage than the impact bombs. With all that done, I'm finally ready to continue the main quest. For real this time.
You just got pumped! Schwam! Schwam! Yeah!
Following the lead Olin gave me about some runes that contain a picture of someone that looked like Aloy, I made my way to Marker's Inn, which is usually where I put the cap. Talking out loud like a crazy person near the runes, and the unknown caller contacts me again. He tells me the mysterious woman's name is Elizabeth Sobek. Yeah, that's the Egyptian gator god. Now that's an alligator Erwin would top.
Crikey!
Fought through some cultists and corruptors on the way in. The new weapons made these fights easier, but they were still hard. Even though I'm over double the recommended level for this mission, I was still getting my ass handed to me. The corruptor is a hard machine to kill with the tripwires because it doesn't charge or walk towards me often. It would often stay back and toss rocks or grenades at me, or it would jump and try to land on me, which meant if I put any wires in front of it, it would just jump over them. Thankfully, I spent all that time grinding and got other powerful weapons, like the Shadow Sling and the Rattler I used to kill it. At the entrance of the ruins, I encountered my first Deathbringer. What a cute name. Before being spotted by it, I set up a bunch of tripwires in between us in case it started to advance on me. Once I started fighting, I realized this Deathbringer is broken and can't move. Because of that, it's pretty easy to kill, so I just hid in cover and slung bonds at it. Didn't take too long, but it's because this Deathbringer only has 1/4 of the HP of a normal fully activated one. Fighting a full health Deathbringer is going to be way harder. Like your dad after a Cialis. picked up an enemy focus before being sucked into a vortex made out of ant flow. That's Hades, that's what they made him look like, don't know why. Anytime you see this weird red goo, it's supposed to symbolize that Hades is there. Hades thought I was killed at the proving, so he has a tantrum that I'm still alive, and the focus explodes.
Uh-oh, that's not good.
Yeah, no shit, that can't be good. What a moron.
Oh, spaghetti.
Learn Dr. Sobek isn't that punctual. I mean, yeah, I don't know why you'd expect an alligator to show up for your meeting on time. This building is the HQ of Faro Automated Solutions, or FAS for short. It was a tech company that built a lot of stuff, like the Focuses, which is pretty cool, and peacekeeping robots like the Deathbringer, which is not pretty cool. I'm gonna say it. Deathbringer is not a good name for a peacekeeping robot. Unless the peace is prefaced by Arrestin, I don't think that robot is gonna be doing much peacekeeping. As I walk through the building and get more info about the past, the unknown caller even sends me what he knows, including this bio about Elizabeth Sobek. It explains that she was some sort of super tech genius, but it does that trope all stories do in trying to talk about someone who was a genius, and I f***ing hate it. They say Sobek was so smart that she went to uni when she was 13, which is f***ing stupid.
I was like, shut the f*** up.
Yeah, you tell him, Chris. Bro, she can't even watch graphic movies at a theater, and you're letting her go to a school that's filled with adults who are spending all their free time drinking and with no supervision? Like, I'm not crazy to think that this would either fuck up the kid or they would just end up kidnapped, right? She's 13, dog. She's supposed to be learning about how to use a tampon for the first time, not experimental physics. Also read the bio about the FAS company. All you gotta know that it was the world's richest company and the world's largest military supplier. So its peacekeeping robots were everywhere. The more I explored, the more it became clear that something was going wrong in the company. Found a room that showcased all their military robots. Not only do they have the Deathbringer and Corruptor, but they also have a giant robot called the Metal Devil that has the ability to self-replicate the other two machines, and can be powered by biomatter, so it never needs to be refueled. Wow, that seems like a great idea for a robot. Took a break and talked about the Purge movies for a bit, where I learned from Scroggs that there's actually a Purge TV series, which was completely new information to me. I had no idea. Like, I knew they kept making movies for that series, which probably should have died after the first movie, but goddamn, a whole ass TV show of that I'm just saying, whoever funded that should not be allowed to control their estate anymore. Like, it feels legally irresponsible to let someone make decisions that are that stupid with their money. Talking about the Purge reminded me, for some reason, of The Thinning, a Logan Paul movie. No, not that one. This one was a YouTube Red movie they made to try to get people to pay for a website that was already free. Yeah, how'd that work out for you, Susan? Not so good, huh? And Elon is doing it now too. Do these morons not realize a big part of why people use their sites is because they are free and most of us are too broke to use other things? The Thinning is one of the worst concepts for a movie ever. The world is overpopulated, so to help curb that, they make all the kids take a test and kills whoever scores low. This movie is literally just about killing the dumbest kids in class. Don't ask me how Logan Paul made it this far, because we both know that's bullshit. They made a sequel, but it was pushed back a few years because of something controversial that happened with Logan. You know, I can't remember what it was though. Ah, man, like it's just hanging by a thread there. I can almost remember it. Nah, whatever.
I've made a severe and continuous lapse in my judgment.
At the top of the tower, Aloy finds out what was going wrong at FAS. A group of peacekeeper robots became glitched out. They were no longer under the control of humans and were enslaving other robots to their command, while self-replicating, making more glitched out robots. And to make it even worse, they were using biomatter to fuel themselves. What all that means is there's a swarm of unstoppable, top-of-the-line military robots growing exponentially that can gain control of anything autonomous, create copies of themselves, and were eating everything in sight for fuel. Within 15 months, they would cause a total extinction event. The last hologram shows Sobek coercing FAS CEO Ted Faro to fund the project that would save the world, Horizon Zero Dawn.
Roll credits.
But he complains, saying the cure is worse than the disease and how he doesn't understand this is the best solution. But it must have worked, right? The world didn't end. It's not a barren rock devoid of life, so the Faro robots must have been stopped. But then how are the ancients wiped out? Somehow their civilization ended, but the world didn't? So what the hell is Horizon Zero Dawn?
It's actually a Sony exclusive that came out in 2016.
Funny, shut up. Before leaving, the unknown caller reveals himself via hologram. He tells me his name, Silence. He's been trying to uncover the past his whole life, and because Aloy can access the runes, he might be able to finally do it. So they agree to work together to figure it out. But Silence is a bit of an asshole.
If you still got questions, be quick about it and stop wasting my time.
Silence is f***ing annoying as f*** because he desperately needs an Aloy because she has access, and he's being a petty little bitch now.
Oh, you have time.
Yes, you do. You just said within 5 seconds she uncovered shit you've been spending your life to uncover. You got time to listen to her, dude. She's your fucking god right now.
Thankfully, Aloy puts him in his place.
Now that's enough talking. Be on your way.
Oh no. All I have to do is take this thing off my head, and you'll be blind, deaf, and dumb. So quit complaining and answer my questions. I'm a
boss. After chatting for a bit, Silence tells me the place Sobek was heading to the Lost Hologram was at the Grave Horde, a ruin inside a Metal Devil. So I head there. Well, not before obliterating a rat.
Fought some cultists at the entrance of the ruins, and more of them inside. Like normal, if I could, I would pick up any leader weapons and use it on them. Aloy proves she's smarter than your cousin on Facebook that keeps fighting you to the Flat Earth group.
During eclipses, the shadow cast on the moon is curved.
Notice that this hallway had a lot of heals and a loot crate, so yeah, there's about to be a boss fight. Gone to this room as a cultist released a brand new Deathbringer from the Metal Devil. This game wants you to rappel down there to fight, but why would I give up the high ground when I can just fight it from up here? Can't believe the devs were dumb enough to leave this in. I have perfect cover from up here. Why would I go down there? Oh, that's why. Never mind.
Okay.
So yeah, I have to go down there for the fight. Started off by taking care of all the cultists in the area, which wasn't too bad, especially in this little building where I had cover from the Deathbringer's fire. After that, I started fighting it. This one has full health and can move, so it's going to be hard. Using no boats made this fight extremely difficult. Unlike other machines, the Corruptor, but especially the Deathbringer, are designed to be fought with the bow. They are fully armored, except for their weapons, and then the brief moments when its heat cores are open. That means in order to have effective damage, I need to have accurate and quick fire. Using the Rattler, which requires me to be up close, is not great because it's harder to dodge attacks. Using the Sling Bombs isn't great because the projectiles are so slow that it's difficult to target weak points consistently, and my weapon that deals the most damage, my trusty Tripcaster, sucks total ass, like a hooker who's really into their job. The Deathbringer barely moves, so I can't get it to walk into the wires, and even if I did, the damage wouldn't be a lot because its legs are all armored. So yeah, this is gonna be hard. Honestly though, I'm smart enough to figure this out after a few tries. I just gotta trust myself. I always make jokes about me being really bad at these games, but I know I'm actually good. One can call me a pro gamer.
Another Kopish. And this one can...
Stealth killed this one guy so good he ended up going through the floor and killed the cultist by setting up tripwires and watching them run into it. Tried again, taking on Deathbringer, and got bodied again. Next time, I started off by tossing a bunch of sticky bombs on it before running to the rappel location, but I accidentally rolled to my death for a second time. Doing this twice within 5 minutes prompted me to question my existence, but I can't focus on that right now. I gotta kill this guy. When I respawned, I thought maybe the devs coded the platform where the rappel hook is to be unbreakable, unlike the rest of the platform. So if I went there and lobbed bombs, I might not be shot down. Unfortunately for me, the devs actually playing tested this game, unlike a few other games I've played recently. After a few more deaths, I changed my strategy. So I got my Rattler and used the freeze bolts to freeze the Deathbringer. And at that point, I would just lob as many bombs as I could at him while he was taking the extra damage. I wasn't aiming, the shots were very short, but doing this let me throw as much as I could at him as fast as possible. It's like using tongs to stretch open your pee hole so you can pee much faster. No, it's not like that at all. I don't know why I wrote that down. That's not at all what that's like. You know what? You can dislike the video. I'm sorry. That was bad. Feel free to dislike this video. I'd sincerely apologize. Anyways, this worked really well. I switched back to shooting bombs at him normally for the last bit and took him down. In the next room, I got another hologram to pass. Aloy learns that in order for Zero Dawn to be complete, the military would need to send every person capable to the front lines. They wouldn't stand a chance, but sending them to their deaths would give the time they needed to finish the project. In the second audio, you learn they did complete Zero Dawn, and just in time, but at the cost of millions of lives. This was a very serious conversation that I was listening to intently. But if this confirms that they did complete Zero Dawn, then why did they all die? With the name of the other project site, Aloy and Silence start discussing how to get there when he tells me it's underneath the city of the Shadow Karja. The bad guys, all the members of the cult, come from this tribe. If their focus is to detect Aloy, Hades will send out another kill order, so Silence comes up with a plan to crash her network and tells me to meet him at that location.
1 million dislikes, or I'll drown myself!
Outside the cultist's main base, Silence tells me the plan. Basically, I gotta find a modified tall neck within their camp and destroy it to disable their focuses. Aloy's smart enough to know Silent knows too many intimate details about this camp to not be involved with the cliffs, so she starts questioning him. He says he was never actually a part of them, only assisted them before he realized they were evil. But he refused to tell Aloy what he assisted them with, has another sissy fit, and then leaves. Very sus behavior. What, did you think I was gonna do the Among Us noise again? I'm not going to do that joke every time I say the word sus. See? I didn't do it. Aloy still heads into the camp. She has a lot of trust in men who might be evil. Personally, I don't know if I can trust him after acting that sus. God damn it. Successfully stealth past the machines. That's a lie. I suck at stealth in this game. Once inside the camp, I tried stealthing past the guards, but like I said, I suck at stealth in this game. Got to the top of the tall neck, and it turns out Hades is there. He tries to attack me, but I destroy the network before he can. Unfortunately, Hades, every human, and every machine in the camp now know I'm here. No shot in hell she makes this jump in real life. Well, I guess none of this would happen in real life, so. I gotta run out of the camp as fast as possible. This is one of the sections games will have where you're supposed to run an impossible escape as enemies lay down a hail of fire from just out of reach, but devs will almost always code
code sections like this, so it's a lot harder to kill the player. The enemies will do way less damage or have way worse aim compared to normal gameplay. Like, I get it, I'm not complaining. They have to do it this way or else it won't seem intense. I'm just mentioning it because I knew you wouldn't have to rush as much because odds are the enemies won't be able to kill me anyways. Turns out I don't have to worry about the enemies killing me though. Just gotta worry about my one brain cell that made the decision to jump into nothing. Died on my second try because I forgot to heal and broke the laws of physics for the second time this run. Got past the cliffside on my third try, finally, ran past every single enemy in the camp, and made my great escape. If I could escape. Talked to Silence after getting out, and of course he knew Hades is there. He's just a massive dick. No, not the good type. And didn't want to tell Aloy about it. Aloy heads into the city to enter the ruins hidden beneath them. Past an arena where humans are fighting machines, definitely not foreshadowing that Aloy is going to be thrown in there later. At the ruin entrance, Silence tells Aloy to prepare as much as possible because this is a point of no return. Like any other game, if you hear a character saying that, it's a warning to the player from the dub saying, make sure you go get your shit together because the next part is hard and there's no going back. I decided to listen to the devs. You know, maybe they know more about this game. So I'm back to the nearest trader to go get new outfits. The whole time I've been playing, I've been focusing on upgrading my weapons, but haven't gotten any new outfits, and I probably should now that I'm getting closer to the end of the game. Got bullied by the chat.
No, I have not heard of Updog.
We then started a very important conversation about Transformers and intercourse.
Because your Transformers gets you hoes? What are you saying, Lily? You like pull up in a bumblebee? And you're like, hey baby, let's do it in the back of my car that's also a person, so essentially we're having sex inside of somebody right now. Would that count as a threesome? Like, you f***ed your girlfriend in Bumblebee's trunk. Is that a threesome? Definitely not legal. Whatever it is. Like, it's gotta be, like, against, like, some sort of Geneva Convention. At the end? They actually f***ing Bumblebee at the end? That's so weird, right? That's so weird. Wait, no shot. Yeah, that's even weirder. On the hood? That's weird. Inside is at least, okay, you're inside the car, but doing it on the hood? It's like having sex with your girlfriend on your friend's face while he's sleeping or some shit.
We live among its people now, hiding in plain sight.
And they're just watching! Oh my god, that's even weirder. He's in human form. Look, he's like staring right at them there. No, that's weird as shit. He's like, oh, okay. So, my friends right now are watching my other friend's fuck on top of my other friend's face. So you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to give it very inspirational speech, essentially to no one, and then look off into the sunset. Like, at least everybody else is involved in this weird sex act, you know? You're like, okay, it's like a weird orgy type thing. Whatever. If everybody's a consenting adult, everybody's a consenting adult. Who am I to judge? Eh, come on, we're all perverts deep down. But you're just like, now's the time to give a speech? Like, right now is the time to give a speech? Just do it 5 minutes later. Do it 5 minutes before. Not while they're f***ing in front of you, man. Like, imagine you're at a party, and you just open the door, and you find your, like, best friend, like, railing a girl, and you're just like, you know what, man? I know I can open that business, and I know I can take it to the next level. And I know I could be the one that gets out of the town, because I'm done living. And you're just, like, there railing your girl, and he just keeps talking, but it's, like, dreams and aspirations. Like, that's more weird to me.
Didn't have enough money for any of the outfits, so I went to go grind. Honestly, it was pretty useful doing this now anyways. The extra blaze will be great for the last few missions. Finally had enough cash and got one of the best outfits in the game. People who have played this game before know that the best outfit of the game is actually one you don't have to buy. It's a special outfit called the Shield Weaver. You get it from completing a side quest. The Shield Weaver is incredibly OP though. The outfit makes Aloy invincible for at least one hit before shutting off and taking a few seconds to recharge, during which time Aloy can be damaged. The time it takes to recharge is so short though that the outfit virtually becomes a god mode cheat. And because of that, I chose not to use it for the challenge. I can use it if I need to, it's part of the vanilla game and isn't a mod or cheat, so it's fair game for my challenge rules, but I want to try beating the challenge without using it first. Yes, not using it makes the game harder than it needs to be, but I think using it would just be too easy. And you aren't watching my videos to see me have a good time, you're here to watch me suffer, so let's keep that going, I guess. Headed back to the ruins and went in this time. The door is jammed and must be vented so it can open. Doing that alerts the cultists up top that something's going on, so now Aloy's gotta be fast before they catch her. Inside, I finally learned what Project Zero Dawn is. So it turns out they couldn't do anything to stop the robots. At the rate they were self-replicating and eating, within 16 months the Earth would become an uninhabitable rock, and any attempt to terraform the Earth would be useless as long as the robots were still active. So the first thing they needed to do was generate the encrypted shutdown codes for the feral robots.
But doing that would take at least half a century. So no matter what, the world was gonna end. But somehow, Elizabeth came up with a plan to save us. Kicked some cultist ass quickly, before heading to the next room where Elizabeth explains the project. Now, no matter what, all life on Earth was going to be wiped out. But what if we can recreate today's world hundreds of years later? After the Pharaoh robots were deactivated, Zero Dawn is a terraforming AI project that will first deactivate the robots, then terraform Earth back to its pre-extinction form, and finally reintroduce all forms of life, from humans to fish to rabbits to the crackheads that stand outside your local 7-Eleven. Personally, I wouldn't have added that last one,
but I guess all life is precious, so, you know, whatever.
The project was controlled by one main AI, called Gaia, with multiple subordinate AI functionaries working independently but under the control of Gaia. Each subordinate function was in charge of doing something different from the others. Some were in charge of cleaning up the seas, and others with breeding cloned animals and plants to be reintroduced to the world when the wild was ready. But something went wrong with Zero Dawn. It did recreate life on Earth, but one of its main components, Apollo, was lost. Apollo was supposed to be the database of all human history, culture, and science, designed to be taught to the new humans so they understand the world as well as the ancients did. Unfortunately, that didn't happen, which is why society has regressed to tribal hunter-gatherers. On top of that too, Hades, another one of its subordinate functions, is now trying to resurrect the Pharaoh robots and destroy the new Earth. So what happened? Fought some more cultists, lots of cover was easy, but I still almost killed myself because I decided to attack the last one like an idiot. Used my bombs to clear out another room of cultists, this thing can just obliterate groups of them, it's great. Further in the ruins, I get a rundown of what some of Gaia's subordinate functions are, like Hephaestus, an AI designed to create machines for Earth's terraforming. It's what's been creating all the machines, and it's why each machine serves a specific function. They are all part of the terraforming operation. Scrappers break down old machines so they can reuse metal, grazers eat overgrowth and turn it into fuel, watchers protect worker machines from threats, and up to about 15 years ago, these machines were all more docile, so something changed and caused Hephaestus to become deranged. Also learned about Hades. It's supposed to be an AI built to cause the end of the world again. Yeah, sounds counterproductive, but then again, the old humans seem to be good at doing that. Hades is supposed to act as a failsafe. If Gaia was in the process of terraforming the new Earth, but it started going wrong, Hades would take control of Zero Dawn and reset Earth back to a barren rock so Gaia could try again. So just a giant restart button? I mean, Hades' symbol is basically that. But again, something caused Hades to activate and act on its own. At Sobek's office, Aloy fixes the Alpha Registry, meaning she can finally enter the ruins in her hometown. Silent calls Aloy a no-parent having bitch.
Whatever birthed you into the world was a what, not a who.
You bastard.
Oh no, I had a legitimate birth. It's you, Aloy, who are the creation of a machine.
And Helas tossed one of those grenades from Spider-Man 1 that turned everybody into those funny CGI skeletons. Captured by Helas, I gotta go listen to his crazy ramblings for a few minutes. Honestly, Helas as a character, in my opinion, is super weak. He isn't interesting as a villain at all. He's basically just a religious fanatic obsessed with the sun. He crushes Aloy's focus like the stale Dorito it is, sets loose some corruptors to corrupt a behemoth that's in the arena, and then Aloy is dropped in. Oh wow, what a surprise. I've been thrown into the arena. I could have not have predicted this was going to happen. All my gear is stuck up top, so I gotta bait the behemoth into charging at these pillars to break them so the gear drops down. On my first try, I got one pillar down, but for some reason the second pillar didn't register when he ran into it. I mean, you can clearly see him going through it. Died, and then respawned in my outfit, which wasn't supposed to happen. So, second glitch this mission, I guess. Got the behemoth to charge into both pillars this time, got my gear, and started the fight. Thought I placed blast wires, but they were just shock wires, and wasted them. Got murdered like a minute later. Second try ended the same way the first one did, not good. But on my third try, I just spammed with the bombs till it fell over, ran up, and did what that old saying says. I beat that horse till it died.
Dude, that's not the saying. It's beating a dead horse, not beat a horse till it dies.
What do you mean the saying is beating a dead horse, not beat a horse till it dies?
What do you mean, what do I mean? That's the saying. Why the f*** would it be beat a horse till it dies?
Okay, well, because when I was like 12, like we took a trip to the farm and I got expelled because of what I did to those horses.
Oh my god, what did you do to those horses? You don't actually beat the horses to death?
Oh my god. Oh my god, oh my god, oh my god.
You sick freak.
Helas then sends down the corruptors to finish me off, and Aloy pulls out her bow. I mean, this is a cutscene, so it doesn't count, but I'm pretty sure at this point I didn't have any bows in my inventory, so this shouldn't even be possible, but whatever. Silence pulls up the last minute with his whip. It's just a horse. And he's got one for me too. He then uses this like Roomba on a stick or something to call in a bunch of sawtooths to fight off the corruptors. You might be thinking this is a cool new weapon type that you can use, but nah, it's just a one-time thing used in this cutscene. It would be dope if you craft something like this for tough fights, but you can't. Turns out Silence isn't a blue hologram, but an actual person too. So I guess he's kinda blue?
Kinda.
He gives Aloy a new focus with all her old data installed on it already. He cuts. And I head back to my hometown to finally figure out what the hell gave birth to me.
Was I pushed out of a fleshy vagina, or one made out of metal? God, I hope it was a fleshy one. I feel like the metal one would just, like, chafe the fuck out of you the whole time you're being pushed down that tight, hard metal cervix. You know, then again, it'd be pretty hot. Oh God, my mic's still on. Oh my God.
Here are 8 signs you have a toxic sibling. 1. They don't respect your boundaries.
Fast traveled as close as the game would let me to the All-Mother and started fighting my way in. The cultists and corruptors are everywhere. After killing the first machines, I realized the objective wanted me to reach a certain location and not kill everyone, so I just started booking it there. Once I got up top, a cutscene plays where the Nora War Party joins me to fight a corrupted Thunderjaw. Got absolutely stomped on the second that cutscene ended. Yeah, at full health, even at my high level, with one of the best outfits in the game, I still get one-shotted by a Thunderjaw. This is not gonna be an easy fight. Second try, like normal, ended the same way the first one did. Set up a bunch of blast wires, but honestly, they aren't that useful against Thunderjaws. Even though they do charge at me from time to time, they mainly stay distant from me using a wide variety of range attacks. And both times I was instant killed was when I got close. So I think the best strat is to keep my distance. One of the funnest things you could do while fighting a Thunderjaw is shooting off his disc launcher, only to pick it up and do high damage back at it. Too bad for me, this difficulty makes the health the Thunderjaw so high that this barely does any damage. Got put down like my first dog moments later. I'm coming to see you, Dex. I spawned and died and spawned and died and then spawned and died. I died a lot here, man. This thing is just too strong. So what I decided to do was just kind of camp. Like the most annoying kid in the COD lobby, I spent my time hidden behind the same piece of cover just lobbing bombs from my noob tube. It took a few tries and well over 20 bombs, but eventually I put that T-Rex through another extinction event. After being prompted to go down another rabbit hole, but about music this time, I know, so unlike me. I ended up watching the Let's Get It Started music video just so I can ask the chat if they knew the original title or lyrics of the song. If you don't know what they are, I could give you a million guesses and I promise you, you would not get it. Yeah, that's it. I can't even say it in this video. Guys, I'm trying to be a YouTuber, which means I'm gonna have to stop saying slurs. Ugh, I know, like the only negative of this job is I can't go around saying that stuff anymore. Well, in public, at least. After that, I explained to the chat how the Black Eyed Peas fell off in the English music scene, but for whatever reason, have popped off in the Latin music scene. I'm pretty sure they did the switch deliberately, but they have songs with 500 million plays you've probably never heard of, and they all feature at least one Spanish-speaking artist. I mean, good for them, I guess. I don't really care what language they rap in, but their older music is definitely way more interesting than their new, overproduced pop stuff.
Holy fuck, holy fucking fuck, the body of yours is absurd. I do anything for it, that's my word.
However, I do have a theory as to why this happened. I think will.i.am needs the money, so he changed the band's direction to get more bread. But why would someone in a band as successful as the Black Eyed Peas need more money? Well, I'm about to show you. The only point of this tangent is so I can show you guys this because it's f***ing crazy. In 2011, will.i.am became obsessed with creating new technologies and becoming a major tech personality. Everything he did here was everything. He made things like the Dial, a smart watch with a SIM card, so basically a phone you wear on your wrist, with an AI that was just complete.
Let's have a conversation.
Oh.
Let's talk about music.
Oh man.
Like eating.
Or how about this take?
The device, we're always going to run into this wall of people wanting more power. Why can't we have jackets that power the device? Why can't you wear power? Holy, what? Power. We need to do that.
Or how about when he asked what period you have Android class?
You have Android for fourth period? You have Microsoft for second period?
Or how about this $300 face mask for COVID, which is just a mask with built-in headphones. So instead of buying a pack of 50 masks for $10 and using like old headphones you already own, he expects people to spend $300 on this abomination. No, not that abomination. I'm much less than $300. This one, there's so much more too, like the program in the watch phone thingy he wanted to make that detects the user's mood, so you know when to call them.
More importantly, say for example, you're working and someone calls you with a bad vibe. Why do you want to answer a bad vibe call?
Yeah, it's basically just a very expensive mood ring. It was stupid. It's so weird people just let this happen. I mean, he even got really good opportunities from respected and established technology companies, like Intel, that hired him as Director of Creative Innovations, which is definitely a title that means nothing, implying this was all for marketing. Regardless, all of these failed projects costed him a lot of money. Apparently, he blew through all of what he had, and he now owes the government $500,000 in taxes. But out of all that stuff, the most crazy thing that happened with him is when he worked with NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory to stream the first song from the surface of Mars. Yeah, I don't know. Maybe flat earthers are right and NASA was just a big money laundering op, because I have no idea why they would do this. And specifically, why they would do this with will.i.am. The song was created by will.i.am just for this. It's called Reach for the Stars. And it includes great and memorable bars such as, I know the sky might be high, but baby, it ain't really that high. And I know that Mars might be far, but baby, it ain't really that far. Yes, he rhymed high with high, and then he rhymed far with far. A true musical genius. For real though, I will forever respect this man for his role in Madagascar 2. He played the great Moto Moto. Inside the caves, I talked to the matriarchs quickly before opening the ruined doors for the first time. Now remember, all the Nora are superstitious religious types, so seeing me do this blew their tiny braids like I was Lana Rhodes and they were Danny D. Exploring inside, Aloy learns this place was a cradle, one of the many locations part of Zero Dawn for the purpose of breeding and raising humans. There's a locked door at the back, and I can tell none of the humans raised here were ever able to enter it. After going through it, you learn it's the second half of the facility, where the kids were supposed to go to school and learn about the world through Apollo, which never happened, hence all the religious morons who are now going to think Aloy's a god because she opened a metal door. They just didn't know any better and have never had a chance to learn. At the end of the ruin, Aloy sees a message made by Gaia for her. It explains what happened. 20 years ago, a signal was sent to Gaia that caused Hades to become rogue and active. So in order to stop this from happening, Gaia has to pull a kamikaze and implode herself, taking down Hades with her. Or else, Hades will gain control of Zero Dawn and all life on Earth will be lost. Again. Without Gaia leading the other subordinate functions, they will slowly start to break down and become dangerous, eventually threatening life on Earth, like we've seen with Hephaestus' derangement creating hostile machines. So Gaia must be repaired after Hades is stopped, or else the world will end again. So Gaia orders this cradle site to start the gestation process of a clone of Elizabeth Sobek in hopes that this clone will be raised by the tribe, and then when she's ready, she'll be able to enter the ruins where she can pick up a focus, view this message, and learn what she needs to do in order to repair Gaia. Because she's a clone of Sobek, she'll be able to enter any Zero Dawn facility she needs to. And over time, she'll be able to fix Gaia with Hades destroyed. Once Hades knows Gaia's planning to blow herself up, it realized, hey, I probably don't want to be here, It created a virus to release the shackles that hold it and all the other subordinate functions in place so they can escape from Gaia and not get blown up with her. Where did they go? Don't ask me, I have no idea. As this happened, data is corrupted throughout the system, like the Alpha Registry, meaning Gaia's planet is no longer going to work as intended, hence all the shit Aloy has had to do to enter this ruin in the first place. Before Gaia goes, she tells me that in order to kill Hades now that it is no longer with her, Aloy will need to go into the ruins of Gaia Prime, find the Master Override, wield it, find out where Hades went to, and purge it, or else the world will end. Again. You got out of the ruins and the Nora start worshipping Aloy. Not down with all the praise, she tells them to shut up and let her just go do what she has to do to save the world. I gotta go genocide some deer for more blaze. Spent about another 30 grinding here.
And what I've done today is I've come up with the top 10 reasons why you should be a trucker.
Like the last mission, I just started running to the objective and ignoring all the enemies nearby. I mean, I could probably fight them, but it's just a waste of supplies and time. In the next area, I wasn't as lucky. Because of the Glithawks, I couldn't really climb past them, so I used my Terra Blaster on the Ravager to knock out his gun so I could pick it up and start shooting the bystanders like I'm Kyle Rittenhouse. Once I reach the top, cutscene plays and I get introduced to the Stormbirds. Stormbirds are one of the biggest and most dangerous machines in the game, basically as powerful as a Thunderjarl, but it can fly. Even on a normal run, these things are just a pain in the ass to fight because you have to constantly look straight up to shoot arrows at them while they're like 100 feet above you. But on this run, I can't even do that. Majority of the time, the bird is going to be so far away that none of my weapons will be able to hit it. So I put my Crocs into sport mode and booked it to the ruins. Once I got close enough, a cutscene plays where Aloy takes in the wreckage that occurred when Gaia blew herself up. And somehow, that despawns the bird. I went back to check because I thought it might be fun to at least try fighting it once, but it was gone. So it's basically just a boss battle you can skip by running forward for like 15 seconds. Talk to Silence quickly, he's blue again, and headed inside. Being as dumb as the rock Patrick Star sleeps under has its benefits sometimes. Like, I was too stupid to notice that my GF was cheating on me for years, so it saved myself all the anxiety. I honestly thought she was just really good friends with the whole high school football team, and the sleepovers they had every weekend were totally normal. But sometimes being this stupid doesn't work in my favor. Like right now, when I spent an extra 15 minutes trying to figure out where to go when I'm very obviously supposed to cross this bridge. As I explored the facility, I learned it was the place where Sobek and all the other alphas, the people in charge of each subordinate function, lived. It was the place they would spend the rest of their lives working on Zero Dawn and Gaia as the world ended outside their doors. But unfortunately, Sobek didn't get to do that. 6 hours after Gaia Prime was launched, one of the doors malfunctioned, creating a gap that needed to be sealed from the outside. While everyone else was and arguing about what to do and who should be sacrificed to fix the door, Sobek snuck out and did herself. That's an L. L alert. If you kill yourself, yeah, take that L.
That's her mommy. Kind of. Oh, Jesus Christ.
Starting talking to the chat about games we thought might win Game of the Year, and then we went down this rabbit hole looking at all the games that came out this year. I swear, I don't even remember half of these. Watching the trailer for The Plague Tale, Scloppy asked me a very important question everyone should ask themselves when considering purchasing a new game. Can you f*** the robots? Unfortunately, I cannot. I ask him his favorite game, thinking he'd probably say Cyberpunk, because you can f*** the robots in that game, but he says, I like Cyber Furry f***er, it s gam. Didn't want to look that up because it would definitely get me banned on Twitch, but
I'm not looking that up.
At last, I am but a man. A very, very weak-willed man.
I'll look it up with you guys in a different window.
Think about doing my next challenge in this game, but I feel like the YouTube video wouldn't be that great seeming as everything would have to be blurred. Was reading some reviews when I explained to the chat what Futa is.
Is the Futa content optional? Can it be disabled? You guys know what Futa is? No, it's not chicks with dicks. It's different. Futa is chicks with enormous penises. Like, that's the thing. It's like bigger than the size of their own torso. It's f***ing stupid.
Probably wondering, how the hell do I know what Futa is, huh? At the top of the building, Aloy finds a room filled with the bodies of the Alphas. They all died here together. Either they all drank the punch, or something happened. Watch a hologram that explained one down. Ted Farrow, the CEO of FAS, the company that made the evil robots, was funding Zero Dawn. Although he really wasn't a scientist, so he wasn't actually in control of it. Kind of just footed the bill and got to ride out the end of the world in a bunker. Unfortunately, he went crazy and decided to purge Apollo, so the next era of humans don't make the same mistakes they did. Which is just f***ing stupid. Because, hey Ted, only one person f***ed up and caused the end of the world. It was you! And by telling everyone what happened, we ensure that it doesn't get done again. You know that whole thing about learning from history or else being doomed to repeat it? Yeah, that's what's happening in this game, because Ted was stupid enough to erase all the data of the old world. The new world has no idea what the Feral Plague is, which is why the cult is working with the robots. They don't know it's going to cause the end of the world, they just think it's going to be an army they can use to do some shit. Ted then kills all the Alphas by removing oxygen from the room so they can't recreate Apollo. So because of one guy, the world ended. And because of the same guy, the new humans are left with no knowledge of the past and have to start the human race from square one again. What a dick. Grab the master override.
It's so small.
Okay, well, sometimes small things can be very powerful, Aloy. Maybe you should wait till you try it before judging it, okay? If you're anything like my girlfriend, you'll hate it. Met Silent's at the exit, in person this time. Okay, that's enough of that joke. Silent tells me the truth about his past. Not only did he work with the Eclipse, he founded them, and he was the person that discovered Hades. When Gaia blew up, Hades transported itself into an inactive metal devil to live. He couldn't stay at Gaia Prime or else it would die. Silent, who had just fixed the focus, discovered Hades' signal and went to go investigate. Forever in the pursuit of knowledge, cause he's a nerd, Silent traded all the info he had on the new world for Hades' info on the old world. Hades wanted Silent to tell it specifically about the Spire, a giant tower made by Gaia near Meridian. It's where Gaia originally broadcasted the shutdown codes for the Pharaoh robots. And Hades wants to get there so it could broadcast the codes to turn them back on and end the world again. Once Hades knew he would need help getting to the Spire, he tasked Silent with creating an army, the Eclipse. And Silent just used the Shadow Card's religion against them by convincing them Hades was a god. Why did he do this? So he can learn about physics and calculus. Yeah, truly a bad dude. Not only did Silence help an evil robot that wanted to end the world, he also wanted to bring calculus back into the human zeitgeist, which is just like one of the worst things you can ever do. Like, if there's a list of evils in the world, it goes Hitler up top, then my mom that time she didn't let me sleep over at Sal's because I didn't clean my room, then Silence for resurrecting calculus, and then right underneath that, the terrorist that piloted the planes in 9/11. Silence tells Aloy he must go and gives the most made answer as to where he's going.
Where will you go?
Elsewhere and everywhere.
Oh, shut the fuck up.
He gives Aloy a spear, one that does higher damage and has shock damage. She attaches the override to it, and I start prepping for the last mission of the game. Hades is gonna attack Meridian with a cult to reach the Spire, and I gotta stop them.
Oh, do we have a doozy of a one today? Did Eve have sex with Satan?
I had more than 450 cans of Blaze on me. I thought it was enough. I thought I wouldn't need to grind out more for this last mission. That was a mistake. Sold some loot so I can buy the maximum amount of heals, and warned the king about the coming attack, so at least I'll have a f***ing ton of support for this last fight. When I started this mission, it gave me the option to double check if I was ready, because like it says in all caps,
no way back.
So it's getting pretty serious. The mission starts with the bots advancing. As guards get into position to start fighting them, Helas and his boys start raiding the castle. So I head down there to kill Helas. Got killed right away. There are a lot of enemies here that are high level, so I gotta be careful, but they still get one hit by blast wires. So I just spammed a bunch of them around the place. Got a minigun and started shooting Helas, but he has a crazy amount of health, and also does a crazy amount of damage. He's as strong as the Thunderjaw I fought a while ago. He just tanks everything, nothing seems to slow him down, and he just keeps charging at me, killing me almost instantly. So for my next try, I just gave in and spammed out a ton of blast wires. I didn't want to use a lot of them because I want to save the resources, but at this point, I didn't think it was possible to beat him otherwise. I set up 7 blast wires, which is about 2,800 100 base damage, but he still just walked through it. Picked up the machine gun and started shredding him with it, and he was still walking through it like the fucking Terminator, not even fazed by this. He chased me around the map, and I kept setting up blast wires and healing constantly. After walking through 8 more wires, I killed him. 15 in total. This is my favorite Helas cutscene. Not because he does anything cool, it's because he dies, and the worst villain of the story is now gone. Tarzan my way down to the ridge to fend off the advancing machines. The game lets you use these OP unlimited ammo heavy weapons here, and it's great because that means I won't waste a f***ing ton of supplies doing this. These bad boys can hold up to 6 bombs before spitting them out. Only 2 things suck about this weapon. 1, it has a bit of a charge time, and 2, I have to arc fire shots. But overall, this weapon makes this part of the mission easy, even on ultra hard. Only times I would die is when I spent too long planting wires, allowing machines to get close, or if I stayed too long at one platform. The longer I spent at one, the more accurate the Deathbringer's fire would get. So to avoid getting killed by one, you would have to move to different platforms like every 30 seconds. Most machines are easy to kill, with the exception of flying machines. The weapon is too slow to be good at hitting them efficiently, and I'm also too stupid to move out of the way from a Stormbird dive bombing me. The Stormberm was killed by my allies on my next try. Thanks for the assist, homies. I went to go loot his body, and the game decided I didn't deserve it because I wasn't the one that killed it, so I guess I won't be looting it. After killing the last Deathbringer, another one shoots down the bridge, knocking Aloy out. She sees Hades being dragged towards the spire while drifting in and out of consciousness. Got woken up by Teb, which, by the way, didn't say it earlier, but ridiculous name? He is one letter away from being a button on a keyboard. Started Usain bolting it to the spire, but once I got there, I realized it was too late and Hades had started transmitting the code. There's a cutscene of a kid playing soccer as a Deathbringer wakes up underneath him. Yeah, that kid's about to be turned into a statistic. I can still stop Hades and shut off the machines, but I have to do it fast before Hades finishes transmitting the full code. Otherwise, it's end of the world time. Up top, I meet up with some allies before getting to the spire grounds. Hades knew it was coming, so he brought a friend. A Deathbringer, but not just any Deathbringer. This is the strongest machine in the whole game. It has 4 times the health of a fully operational Deathbringer, and to make it worse, I only have 12 minutes to kill it. If the timer runs out, Hades broadcasts the full activation code, and I lose the game. This thing is a machine. I mean, it literally is, so that's a bad analogy, but you know what I mean. It's actually not the hardest to dodge. It's only one enemy, and I'll spend time focusing on your allies, but this thing just tanks everything you throw at it. Like all Deathbringers, you can only really kill them by targeting their heat cores and weapons, but without a bow, that's very hard, so I mainly just use bombs. Dicky bombs do the most damage, so I use those guys over the other 2 variants. I mainly aim for its weapons, specifically a focus on the big one up top because it was the biggest target, and I like them big, just ask your mother. But I mean, look at the clip I'm showing you right now. I spent over 1.5 minutes just tossing sticky bombs at it while it fired on my friends. I mean, I shot 69 bombs at him here. That's not a joke. I literally counted how many I shot here when he wasn't looking at me. And it was fine. After all that, it was still walking around like nothing happened. This started getting me very, very worried because the amount of bombs this thing was tanking got me scared that I might run out of ammo before I killed it. 69 bombs is 138 cans of blaze, and I walked into this battle with under 300. So I'm not even close to halfway done this fight, and I'm about halfway through my supplies. At this point, a bunch of corrupted machines spawned, so now I gotta worry about those guys too. On the plus side, I wasn't worrying about them much longer. Respawn at a checkpoint before I did the large hail bomb, so I lost all the damage I did there. But for some reason, the game, I guess, glitched out and didn't reset my inventory to what it was at that checkpoint. It gave me the same inventory I had when I died. So I lost about 150 cans of blaze and a bunch of heals without any of the damage I did there being saved. This is very, very bad. Like, very bad. Very, very bad. Very bad. It's, you know what? I'd even go on to say on record, this is very bad. I didn't actually realize this when playing the game, but I knew something went wrong because I was confused about how fast I got low on blaze at this point, but at least now I know what happened. Not like that helps past Chris beat this guy though. Died again and respawned at the same checkpoint, but this time my inventory didn't carry over. It was the same it was last time I died, so it was definitely a one-time glitch. Unfortunately, I will have the reduced inventory every time I spawn. No matter what I do, those items are lost. This life, I also got the chance to start hailing bombs at Deathbringer while he's focused on my friends. I shot almost the same amount I did last time. I shot 64 bombs. I would've gotten past 69, but I ran out of blaze. I went to search around the map for more blaze. There's some stuff you can find in boxes or some on dead machines, but it's not enough to give me a supply of firepower needed to kill this guy. Died again and spawned a new checkpoint. This is after my last barrage of bombs, so I'm pretty sure the damage I did to it carried over, but so did my inventory. Every time I spawn now, I will have 0 blaze. Killed the machines attacking me and went to use every last type of bomb I had on me. I mean, I had like some proximity bombs and stuff, but these things don't do great damage compared to the sticky bombs. Spent some time looking for blaze, and after using everything I could find, I had to switch my Rattler. This thing sucks fat donkey dick. It does 1 damage to its armor, and if I can hit its weapons, I only do like 15 to 20 points of damage per shot. I'd be able to do a bit more damage with my Rattler if I got closer, but if I got closer, I'd be taking a lot more damage, and this thing just has so much health, so I didn't want to risk that. I was constantly shooting, but with only 10 seconds left on the timer, I kind of gave up on dodging because it didn't matter at that point, and it killed me with 2 seconds left. Even if it didn't kill me, I would have just ran out of time and died then. Respawn, and I had 6:30 on the timer. So I know from this point on, I have to be as aggressive as a pit bull is to a toddler soft skull, because
because I only have a bit of time to kill it, and I will run out of time if I don't do enough damage. So this try, I was way more up in its face with my Rattler, shooting its weapons and its heat cords when I could. I took more damage, but I didn't care. I knew I had to play recklessly because I'm more likely to run out of time than I am to get killed by it. And even though I thought I played my best here, I ran out of time. A short cutscene plays where Hades tells Aloy she's too late before resetting me to the same 6:30 checkpoint. The only way I'm going to be able to do this is if I play it like it's an MMO and min-max my time and ammo with the other enemies. So I started to save my strong weapons for only the Deathbringer and use my shock wires to take out some of the other machines faster than I was before. Yeah, I know this is only going to give me a few extra seconds of time, but I needed as much as I could get. I chose to have my HUD off, so I can't tell the Deathbringer's HP. It could be 5,000 HP from dying, or it could just be a few hundred. So I'm going to assume it's on low health and I'm close to killing it, or else there's just no chance in doing this at all. Again, I played aggressive as a frat boy is to some girls just trying to have a good night out at a bar. But it didn't matter. I was not doing enough damage fast enough. Tried a few more times and just kept dying. I took a moment to think because I was seriously considering quitting this mission so I can go grind more plays before trying again.
I can go back and grind. I think that's a move, dude.
I didn't want to because I wanted to finish this challenge during the stream, but I didn't know what else to do at this point. But my father didn't raise no quitter.
He didn't raise anyone. He left us when I was 9.
Nah, I'm just joking. My dad's cool. The real reason I didn't quit was because my laziness for not wanting to stream this challenge again overpowered my laziness to want to quit this fight and try again later. So I gave it one more try. Knowing this was my last try, I lost any sense of self-preservation and attacked the Deathbringer like it was the only machine on the field. This worked in my favor heavily. Because I stayed so close to the Deathbringer, so did the other machines. So as I shot bombs at the Deathbringer, the splash damage would kill the other machines, saving me precious time. And to make it better, some machines, like the Bellowback, did damage to the Deathbringer as I killed it. After dealing with the other machines and switching to my Rattler, I stayed way closer to the Deathbringer than I was before. This was good because my Rattler did more damage, sometimes upwards of 40 damage per shot. It didn't matter if I died, I just had to get as much damage as possible, so I played the most aggressive I've played so far. As aggressive as a 16-year-old Southern white boy hopped on 2 cans of Red Bull and Mountain Dew in a COD lobby with a brand new mic.
Kill yourself.
It was going great. I was doing the most damage I've done so far, but he smacked me back, and when I looked at the timer, I only had about 30 seconds left. Seeing that sucked. My heart sank. I felt defeated because I knew I was going to run out of time again. I sent my brain to autopilot and kept fighting him as best as I could, but I was certain I wouldn't be able to beat the clock. All the guns at its front were gone. There was just one last place it could do high damage, a single turn on its back, so I began shooting it. My position made the Deathbringer constantly rotate so it could face me, but because I was rotating at the same speed as it, it never caught up to me, giving me a lot of time to do as much damage as I could. I kept going despite accepting defeat. I shot a constant barrage of fire as the timer went past 10 seconds, then past 8, then 6, but it didn't get past 5. I killed the strongest enemy and the last boss of this game with literally 5 seconds to spare.
Holy shit, man. Oh my god, I wasn't even looking at the time. I've probably like 10 seconds left. Wow.
Of course I looted its corpse before stopping Hades. Those rare modifications are way more important than stopping the end of the world. Aloy gets a shockgasm. I'm jealous, and then is transported into some weird, like, tech void place? I don't know what this is. I activated the Master Override, and the Pharaoh machines are shut down. The cultists are defeated, Hades is stopped, and I finished Horizon Zero Dawn without using any bows on the hardest difficulty. One fail is not bad for a challenge that took me 42 hours, 26 minutes, and 23 seconds of gameplay, but I still did fail. So no, you technically can't beat all of Horizon Zero Dawn without using a bow on Ultra Hard. I did find out you could beat a New Game Plus run without failing though. When you start a New Game Plus file, you start the game after Aloy ages, so you wouldn't have to shoot the Strider with Ross as a child. I was very surprised this game was beatable with just one fail, and this challenge was a lot of fun to play because it forced me to use weapons I never used when I originally played the game, like the Terra Blaster. Yeah, I got it on my old run, but I had a type of arrow that did the same thing, so I never touched it. Little did I know, the Terra Blaster is way better at taking off machine parts than those arrows are. There are 2 more cutscenes you can watch, one where Aloy goes to find Sobek's corpse, which is kind of weird to me. Also, she would totally not look like that. Her dead body has been in that suit for almost 1,000 years at this point. Second cutscene plays after the credits, which, side note, gotta be the slowest credits ever. Holy shit. Yeah! Silence captures whatever is left of Hades so it can continue draining of knowledge, and more importantly, to find out what woke Hades up in the first place, a question this game doesn't answer. I think its sequel does, but I don't have the funds for PS5, so I haven't played that shit yet. I had so much fun playing this that I want to play the DLC, Frozen Wilds, on the same difficulty with the same challenge. It's already recorded, and a second video will be out soon. So you're gonna wanna sub to my channel so you can watch that video when it drops, because the sequel added some very strong enemies to the game.
As always, follow me on Twitch at twitch.tv/crispy645 so you can watch me record new videos and hang out and chat. Please like the video if you enjoyed it, it really helps me out, and I really appreciate everyone who watches to the end, and I'm sorry for making this video like an hour and a half long. See you guys later, peace.
This is amazing. Did you paint this?
Yeah.